This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, made possible by the Friends of SDPB. Pledge your support for quality programming. Call Friends at 800-333-0789 or donate online at sdpb.org. You may purchase this video and many others online at our website. Click on Shop SDPB. And thank you.
This high school activities championship event is conducted under the auspices of the South Dakota High School Activities Association.
And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, the busiest place in the state of South Dakota over the next 3 days. 7 championship high school football games coming your way over the next 3 days on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Steve Toome, along with Gary Ellenbolt, Craig Maddock, and Mike Hendrickson will be joining us throughout the next few days as South Dakota expands to 7 classes of high school football for this year. 7 championship games coming up here at the Dome. Great to have you here. A lot of excitement at the Dome. Of course, USD and SDSU will be playing on Saturday afternoon. So it's about as busy as you're ever going to see Vermilion, South Dakota.
Get your parking space in Vermilion a week ago, because Saturday is just going to be an incredible day. SDSU and USD sold tickets out in 48 hours when they went on sale in June. So they'll have 10,000, if not a few more, in the Dome. They'll clear them out. Get ready for the 11 AAA game. Of course, the Sioux Falls schools, just an hour from here. They travel well. The 11 AAA final featuring Roosevelt and Lincoln, which could very well be a game for the ages. But we've got some good ones coming up today and tomorrow, too.
You bet. 3 games today. We'll open up with Leola, Frederick, and Potter County in the 9A. We'll follow that up with 2 outstanding programs, Arlington and Bridgewater, Emory, Ethan in the 9AA game. Schedule start about 2:30. Then tonight, it's Madison and West Central. West Central familiar to the Dome. Madison seeking their first state championship in 11A. Then tomorrow, we'll start at the same time. We'll open up with 9B, a battle of unbeatens, Avon and Hamlin at 10:30 Central. And then we'll follow that up with probably the hottest team in the state, the Canton Seahawks, taking on Parkston. That's a rematch of a regular season game. And then we'll finish up Friday night with an ESD grudge match for 11AA. Pier and Watertown. That starts at 7 Central on Friday night. And then on Saturday night, we'll wrap it up with the Class 11 AAA game, Lincoln against Roosevelt. 7 o'clock is when our broadcast coverage begins, Central Time on Saturday night. Let's send it down to the field. Craig Maddock is standing by.
Marty Morlock is the head coach with Leola Frederick. You know, 5 straight seasons now, you've won 8 games or more. This is your first trip to the Dome. What's been the difference this year?
The difference is that we were just able to make some plays when we needed to. Last 4 to 5 semis we've been involved in. And, the first year we got nipped at the end by Viberg Hurley, and then we got fall year we kind of got thumped by Bridgewater and Reith, and they were a pretty solid team in about a 50-mile-an-hour wind. It was kind of a bad omen when they had more points and you had yardage. That's not the best thing, but it was definitely a learning experience. And we came back and got knocked off by Gregory last year in the second round in a shootout. And then this year we were, we had a close game against Woolsey Weston, and they played a very solid game, and the Williams and Lorenz kid were very potent kids. We were able to stop one of them. The other one kind of ran around on us, but our defense came through and made the stop when we needed to.
444 yards of rushing, Woolsey Wessington in that semifinal game. How were you able to overcome that?
That's a pretty good day at the office there.
Yeah.
Our boys defensively, we came up and made the stop when we needed. They had 400 some odd yards of rushing, and when it came down to it, they just needed 2 yards, but our defense was able to stop them.
What about this game? You've played Potter County. It was a month into the season. It was only 12-7. You guys have been scoring a ton of points ever since. What's going to happen in this game?
We both have very very salty defense, run defense as well. We've been able to make some improvements on our pass defense over the rest of the season. we tweaked and worked on a couple things the last couple weeks of the season to if we had the opportunity to play them again, to try to get a body on some of their guys a little bit better, a little bit quicker, and get a little different scheme.
You get a lot of turnovers in that last game. Do you expect that to be the key today?
You know, that's going to be huge for us. If we're able to create those turnovers and get those turnovers, that's going to be huge. You know, we're an aggressive defensive team, and we look to get that ball because our defensive boys are greedy. They want it.
Coach, good luck.
All right, thank you.
And Coach Marty Morlock, Leola Frederick, their first trip to the Dome. We've got more as the 9A Championship coming up here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. Steve Toome, Gary Ellenbolt, and Craig Maddock here getting ready for the 9A championship game between Potter County and Leola Frederick. We heard from Marty Morlock a moment ago. Leola Frederick, the Titans, unbeaten on the year, averaging 45 points a game, only giving up 8 points per game on defense. They average 260 yards on the ground per game and 94 via the pass. There you see the profile of the two schools.
Up in the northeast corner of the state, Frederick just a few miles away from the state of North Dakota. They combine for about 90 kids as far as their enrollment in Leola and from Frederick in Class 9A. Leola at one time the Pirates, Frederick the Vikings. Frederick getting here in 1982 and the Vikings defeating Gettysburg in the state championship. They also have a history this year. They were unbeaten in one of several games of the century in the state of South Dakota. They went to Gettysburg, took on Potter County, and defeated the Battlers by a 12-7 score. And I like what Marty Morlock said about a greedy defense. You look on the right column there, since Leola Frederick has won all its games, they gave up 19 points the final 5 weeks of the year.
They were very solid during the regular season. Their closest game against Potter County, then into the playoffs. They took care of business against Viberg Hurley 56-6. They shut out Lemon McIntosh 38-0. And what a contest in that semifinal. With 2 seconds left, they stopped Wolsey Wesslington at about the 2-yard line to win 38-34. Let's send it down to the field. Craig Maddock is standing by with Vern Smith, the head man for the Battlers.
Coach, you're not a stranger to the title games. You've been the coach with Gettysburg a long time, but this is the first time Hovind is with Gettysburg in Potter County, the first trip. How excited is Hovind this year?
Oh, I think they're really excited. Just as excited as what Gettysburg is. I mean, that's one of those things that as the year went on, the kids start pulling together a little bit more all the time, and so did the fans, and I think there's a lot of excitement in both towns.
You're averaging over 33 points a game. What's making your offense tick this year?
Well, we try and change things up a little bit, give teams different looks, make them do some adjustments, as the game's going on. Obviously, our quarterback does a huge job for us as far as being our ball carrier sometimes, our passer. But we've got a lot of guys that, as the year's gone on, have stepped up and played really well for us. Without that confidence, without that getting together as a team, you don't get to this level.
Both these teams scoring a lot of points, but when you guys played earlier this year, it was only 12-7. Are you expecting that kind of a game today?
I don't know if I expect quite that low. I think it might be one of those that I think if one team gets hot and scores a lot of points, I think the other team has the capability of doing that. I think it's going to be a close game. I don't know if it's going to be a real high-scoring game, but I think it's going to be close in the 20s or 30, right around 30, something like that. But I think it's going to be one of those that's going to be intense and competitive all the way through.
Coach, congratulations. Good luck today.
Thank you very much.
Head Coach Vern Smith, again, Potter County, first time they've been here as Gettysburg and Hovind. More of the State A tournament coming up, the State A championship on the way here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, getting you ready for the 9A championship game between the Battlers and the Titans, the first of seven games over the next 3 days here at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. I'm Steve Toom along with Gary Ellenbold and Craig Maddock joining us on the sidelines here. Let's talk about the Titans, the unbeaten team coming into this matchup. Leola Frederick, their first time here at the Dome. Here is the starting lineup for the Titans.
And they run pretty good size for one of the smaller schools in the state. You've got Padal at 200 pounds, then 180 for Matt Hoffman. Matt Weiser, 230 pounds. Nathan Sumption at 225. And then on the other end is Austin Herner at 165 pounds. Look at number 25, Carson Hurdle. He was more or less the hero in the win over Woolsey Westington as he stopped the quarterback from getting into the end zone at the 2-yard line on the final play of the game. Hurdle and the Titans for their effort rewarded with a championship game here against Potter County.
Dane Campbell has passed for over 1,000 yards on the season. He's also scored 6 rushing touchdowns. Logan Weiser is the focal point of their offense. He has over 1,000 yards rushing, averaging 10 yards a carry. He's also caught 19 passes on the air. He's averaging 22 yards a reception. He has combined for 22 offensive touchdowns. Evan Emery has combined for 8 touchdowns, 7 on the ground, 1 through the air, 5 rushing touchdowns for Karsten Hurdle, the senior running back, as the defensive starters here for the Titans in their 4-man front.
All right, and Jimmy King, a tackle, also a kicker, has the lone field goal for Leola Frederick this year. Kicked a 38-yarder. Weiser, Herner, and Padal across the front end. And then looking at the linebackers and the defensive backs, they'll run 2 DBs, 3 linebackers at a 4-man front. Sumption, Weiser, Hurdle again. Justin Helland gets the start as a defensive back, and you don't want to say old. They're hardly old by any means, but a very senior-dominated team.
The Titans, we mentioned, 260 yards per game on the ground offensively, 94 through the air, 354 yards is what they average as far as their offensive output, 45 points per game, just giving up 8 points on defense, though they gave up 34 in the semifinal to Woolsey Westington, a very solid team, a very good running football team with some great athletes. And again, they were up by 20 points where the Titans, with 8 minutes left, looked like they had it wrapped up. But then Woolsey Westington stormed back, and they got a play down to the 2-yard line, I think it was, with just a couple of seconds on the clock. They spiked the ball. So that last play, that was a winner-take-all with the score being 38-34, and the Titans, their defense came up big.
Woolsey Westington's Warbirds sent Lorenzo Williams to the right side. Some of the Leola Frederick players on the defense were thinking that maybe he'd try to punch it in up the middle for 2, but no, they went on the option right side. Hurdle was able to smell it out and made the stop at the 2-yard line. And that is how the Titans get here, wearing their home Navy uniforms. And they'll have some great trim and white numbers on there. The Potter County squad, the Battlers, kind of look like the Coyotes of the gray pants and kind of the, not quite cardinal, but a deep red numbers and helmets.
We'll take a timeout, come back. We'll introduce you to Potter County in just a moment. You're watching the Class 9A Championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, getting set up for the 9A championship game between Potter County and Leola Frederick. We've met the Titans. Now let's meet the Battlers of Potter County, coming in with a 10-1 mark on the year. Vern Smith, the veteran head coach. There you see the respective team captains gathering for the coin toss, which was it's always done before the teams actually are introduced to the crowd here at the Dakota Dome. Potter County. There you take a look, Gettysburg and Hoven, their matchup there. Gettysburg, of course, a familiar visitor to the Dakota Dome. 7 championship appearances as Gettysburg. They finished runner-up in every previous trip here at the Dakota Dome. Now, as Potter County and the Battlers, they keep the same red, white, and silver colors. Very familiar to fans across that part of the state, and actually across the state, because Gettysburg has had so many outstanding teams in various sports. You know, our colleague Mike Hendrickson always says, hey, when the Gettysburg or Potter County bus shows up, you know a good team's getting off that bus because they've had success in all across the sports field.
They opened up with kind of the nickname bowl in the first week as the Battlers played the Rustlers of Miller and got the 45-13 win. Then took care of Sully Buttes and Timber Lake before falling for the only time this year to Leola Frederick, their opponent here at the championship game. Then defeated Harriet Selby area, Eureka Battle, McLaughlin, Wakpala, and Fulton area in the regular season. Their march to the state championship went like this. Took on Corsica Stickney and defeated the Jaguars 42-0. A 44-30 decision over Harriet Selby area again. And then a game that really opened a lot of eyes around the state because Howard had a great season unbeaten to the state 9A semifinals. Home to Potter County in the semifinal and ended up falling the Battlers in all eight cylinders and getting the 22-8 win.
Yeah, Howard was expected to win that game. They had a great running back in Luke Loudenberg, but it was the Battlers prevailing. And here's the starting lineup for Potter County.
It is a mixture of seniors and juniors with one sophomore thrown in, Michael Rausch, Kirby, Trayson Drew, Aaron Beach, and Lucas Vogel across the front line. As they go, you kick out the tackles in nine-man football. You just go guard, center, guard. Chase Hall is going to do a boatload of work today as he has done most of the ball carrying for Potter County this year.
Yeah, he's their leading ground gainer, 762 yards, 10 rushing touchdowns, averages 8.5 yards a carry. He's also thrown for 984 yards, 16 touchdown passes. Hayden Simon, he'll be the main running back. He's run for close to 400 yards. And Mitchell Hinckley and Tanner Hewer, those are the skill players for the Potter County Battlers. Again, not a real guy that puts out the superstar numbers, but a lot of different weapons. A lot of guys you have to account for offensively for the Potter County Battlers. Now on defense for Potter County.
Hayden Simon, 5'11", 180-pound senior. Carson Kirby is a sophomore. Then Scott Gloat, who is a relative of the superintendent of schools, appeared. Of course, the Governors play tomorrow night in the 11AA championship. Then Lucas Vogel, a defensive end, 6'4", 190-pound junior. They will run with three defensive backs as opposed to the two for Leola Frederick, Sundberg, Hinckley, Hall, Hewer, and Chase Hall, the quarterback. And as seems to be typical when a team has a small roster and goes both ways, quarterback ends up playing the free safety spot. And this is the case for the Battlers.
Or the linebacker spot in some cases.
Right.
You kind of think, what in the world are you doing playing your quarterback and linebacker? But in these nine-man and in some cases 11-man schools, you have to because he's probably the best athlete on your team. So you get a look at veteran head coach Vern Smith, his team averaging 33 points a game. They only give up 10.5 points on defense. We'll take another timeout, come back, get you ready for the 9A championship game. Leola Frederick getting set to take on Potter County. This is South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, getting ready for the 9A championship football game between the Potter County Battlers and the Titans of Leola Frederick. First time for these co-op teams here at the Dome. Frederick and Gettysburg battled back in 1982. There you get a look at the two coaches, getting a chance to talk things over here at the Dakota Dome. Of course, perfect conditions inside the dome. That's why the coaches are wearing the cargo shorts. Can't do that in November outside in South Dakota.
It's really not a good idea unless you want to end up, say, with the ride of the Mickelson Center or something like that. But no, conditions are perfect. Plenty of room if you're in the area and would like to take in some good high school football. We have got a great game here. One of the things that has been a concern, and we've watched and broadcast several games here this year, as the field condition, the turf is in its second year here, and it really takes some getting used to if you have not played on it or had much of a chance to practice.
No, I mean, even for teams that are frequent visitors to the Dakota Dome, if you haven't been here in a few years, it is a little different. There you get a close-up look at the new artificial surface here at the Dakota Dome. Now, this is not field turf.
No.
They can't have it in here because they have to roll it up for the indoor track and also for basketball that they play here inside the Dakota Dome. So field turf isn't an option for that because you just can't roll up field turf. However, it is a very good surface, but it is a little different than artificial turf is and different from the field turf. Now, some of the 11 AA and AAA schools, they get to play on field turf, and it's different than, say, Howard Wood Field. I've been on that field before. Great, great surface up there, but this is a different field, and you, this is where pregame warm-ups are really, really important. You think, ah, they're just going through the motions, but you've got to get used to the feel of what it's like to run and make cuts on this surface.
Craig Maddock is down there now, and Craig, you wouldn't think that field would play much of a difference or be much of a factor in the course of a game. But again, if you're not used to this, if you try to make a cut and cut wrong, you can end up on your keister in a bit of a hurry.
And I was talking with Coach Marty Morlock after he was taping some of his linemen up here prior to the game. Some of the players are actually wearing the cleats that they would wear outside. Some of the linemen, some of the big boys, they're wearing those inch and a half spikes on their shoes today. Some of the quicker players, though, they've gone to the tennis shoe. So I think a lot of it could be just a preference factor for both these teams. They have been in here, they have practiced to see what it feels like. But it kind of looks like the linemen, they're sticking with their regular shoes while the speedier guys are going with the tennis shoes.
Yeah, it was always something on the old turf. You saw a lot of guys wear the old turf shoes back in the 80s, and then a lot of guys wore tennis shoes. Not necessarily the case now with this new surface here at USD inside the Dakota Dome. Also, you talk about the speed factor. It seems like when you get evenly matched teams, as certainly these two teams are based on their previous encounter, really, it's been the case more than not that the faster team has the advantage. And we saw it a couple of years ago when Harrisburg played Del Rapids in the 11A game, I think it was. They played pretty close during the regular season, but Del Rapids was the faster team, and that paid off for them as they got an easy win over Harrisburg.
And in 11A, you have a bit of an advantage because every couple of years you come here and play Vermilion. Vermilion High School, of course, uses this field as their home field, and you know, Del Rapids comes here. Harrisburg used to before going up to 11AA last year, but it is a different surface in a different situation than field turf. And if you're a team coming in here for the first time and run, say, the option offense, that might take some adjustment and take a while to get that option going because you have to make the cuts. You have to run to either side, and it can be an issue, again, trying to make cuts and trying to keep the offense going.
Now, got to remember, too, guys, remember the old days, we would always talk about these teams playing on an 80-yard field.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot of teams are doing that anymore. Certainly, you can still play on the 80-yard field with nine-man football. A lot of them now have chosen to go ahead and play on the 100-yard field.
Right, and one of the things, I know Minnesota does this. They will actually, during what they call the prep bowl, during the nine-man games, they will shorten the field to make it 80 yards and just kind of cut it off at the 20-yard line. If you want to kick a field goal, you're going one direction, then you have to go in the other. And fortunately, in South Dakota, they'll let him go ahead and play on the 100-yard field, which has to seem huge if you're playing on 80 yards all year.
Yeah, and they do that down in Nebraska with eight-man football. They will actually put the big yellow lines down in the football field down in Lincoln at Memorial Field for the eight-man championship. So, it looks a little weird, but you know, quite often in the past when you've had teams on the 80-yard field, they get out here on the 100-yard field, it's like, wow, it's a long way to the sideline, and teams that like to turn the corner always seem to have an advantage. If you can get your fast guy to the outside, you are in very, very good shape.
The 9A game coming up in a few minutes. Let's go down to our public address announcer, Greg Merrigan.
Please try not to interfere with the coaches and athletes within the team box. Members of the media should restrict themselves to the area between the 25-yard lines and the end zone. It is permissible for the media to be on both sides of the playing field. Thank you for your cooperation. And this reminder, the Football Advisory Meeting and the Football Coaches Association All-Star Selection Meetings will be held 45 minutes after the 9AA game this afternoon at Vermilion High School. Coaches are asked to use the southeast entrance to the auxiliary gym.
Yes. history.
A lot of controversy coming into this season about the seventh class being added to high school football. And, of course, this is a two-year experiment. This will happen again next year, and then the Activities Association will revisit that and see if there's any modifications that need to be made. Of course, a extra class being added to the 11-man teams, with the top eight teams in enrollment being now 11 AAA. And then I believe the next dozen were class 11AA, and then you move down to 11A and 11B. And, of course, the nine-man classes remaining the same as in past years.
Mm-hmm. And a couple of those classes, 11AAA and 11A, everybody in the field got to go because you have the top eight schools. There's an eight-man playoff at 11AAA. 11A has 16 participants. 15 of those played. Little Wound decided to forfeit its first-round game at Hot Springs. But in 11AA, there are 10 schools in the class. Eight went, Sturgis and Spearfish not making the playoffs in 2013. But we'll see a really good 11AA game tomorrow as a couple of schools from the ESD, Eastern South Dakota Conference, are doing battle. Shea Bratland and the Watertown Arrows taking on Pier here. That'll be tomorrow night. Really good 11A game, of course, this evening. And then through our games today, you've got Leola Frederick taking on Potter County. That is the 9A game. 9AA coming up roughly, give or take, 2:30. That will be Arlington against Bridgewater Emory Ethan. Both of those schools have made several appearances at the Dome as well. Looking at Marty Morlock, the head coach at Leola Frederick. The Titans again in the home navy, and they will have the gray trim numerals, white numerals trimmed in gray. And this just has to be exciting. No matter how many times you've been here at the Dakota Dome, it's just a great moment, not just for the players, but for fans, for people make the trip to Vermilion for the weekend. And it's kind of a cool moment for us too, Steve.
You bet. And don't forget, you can become an electronic fan of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. There's inside information, behind-the-scenes photos, fun facts, and lots more. Go to sdpb.org, click on Engage to find our Facebook and Twitter links. And sdpb.org is the place where you can watch the game online. So if you've got friends or relatives anywhere in the world that they've got an internet connection, give them a call, shoot them an email, tell them that go to sdpb.org. They can follow the action all weekend long. We'll also have photos posted of the winning teams and the various award winners. Those will be announced, of course, after the particular football games. We've got Bridgewater, Emory, Ethan, and Arlington coming up in a little bit. But first, our first of seven games getting set. Potter County to take on the unbeaten Titans of Leola Frederick. Should be a dandy here in just a moment. We will turn things over to Mr. Greg Merrigan. He will be our public address announcer for this first contest. Great that you could join us here today on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. My name's Steve Toon, Gary Ellenbolt with me, Craig Maddock on the sidelines, and now let's turn it over to Mr. Merrigan.
On behalf of the South Dakota High School Activities Association, along with its corporate partners, Sanford Health, First Premier Bank and Premier Bank Card, Farmers Union Insurance, Billion Automotive, and the South Dakota Army National Guard, we welcome you to Vermilion for the 2013 South Dakota State Class 9A Football Championship Game. We would like to remind everyone that good sportsmanship on the part of coaches, players, and spectators is crucial to the future of athletics at all levels. The South Dakota High School Activities Association supports the need for proper behavior on the part of everyone in athletics. Be a sport and support good sportsmanship during the football championship games. At this time, fans, let's meet the cheerleaders for both squads. First for Potter County, Lily Cronin, Reagan Everson, Cameron Decker, Alyssa Haber, Kaylee Hansen, and Megan Shrimp. And for Leola Frederick, Brittany Casey, Demi Truenbach and Haley Weimer. And now let's meet the starting lineups for this championship game. First, the offensive unit for Potter County. Wearing number 14, an end, Michael Rausch. Number 46, an end, Lucas Vogel. Number 51, a guard, Carson Kirby. Number 88, a guard, Aaron Beach. Number 33, the center, Trayson Drew. Number 5, the wingback, Tanner Howard. Number 9, a running back, Hayden Simon. Number 30, a running back, Mitchell Hinckley. And number 8, the quarterback, Chase Hall. The Battlers are coached by Vern Smith. And now let's meet the defensive unit for Leola Frederick. Wearing number 14, an end, Austin Horner. At end, number 55, Derek Podol. At tackle, number 56, Matt Weiser. At tackle, number 37, George Lapke. At linebacker, number 25, Karsten Hurdle. At linebacker, number 28, Logan Weiser. At linebacker, number 30, Nathan Sumption. At defensive back, number 4, Evan Emery. And at defensive back, number 7, Justin Helland. The Titans are coached by Marty Morlock. The officials for this championship game, the referee is Brian Weber of Bridgewater. The umpire, Doug Weber of Bridgewater. The head linesman, Gene Hansen of Emory. The line judge, Tom Weidenbach of Sioux Falls. The back judge, Greg Morehouse of Newcastle. And the alternate, Nathan Walter of Freeman. And now let's stand as the Pine Ridge Junior ROTC Color Guard posts the national colors and the playing of our national anthem. It is requested that men wearing civilian clothing hold their hats in their left hand and place their right hand over their heart during the playing of the national anthem. It's requested that you remain standing until the colors have left the field. From left to right, the color guard is comprised of the following cadets. Cadet Peyton J. One Feather, Honor Guard. Cadet Kiva Goodcrow, carrying the national colors. Cadet Tori Ann M. Little, carrying the South Dakota colors. Cadet Savannah Ghost Dog, carrying the Pine Ridge colors. Cadet Laura Waters, carrying the Pine Ridge Junior ROTC High School colors. Cadet Fallen Sorbell, Honor Guard. And Cadet Kiva Goodcrow, Commander. They are directed by Major Ewan and First Sergeant Lovato. And ladies and gentlemen, will you please stand as we honor America with the singing of our national anthem? The national anthem will be sung by Mary Elizabeth Watts, a student at Aberdeen Roncalli High School.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. On the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that a flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave on the lands of the free, in the home of the
Fans, we direct your attention to the rafters above the Dakota Dome, where Sergeant Jacob Visha will be rappelling from the roof with today's game ball. Ladies and gentlemen, Sergeant Jacob Visha of the South Dakota Army National Guard. And now, ladies and gentlemen, please direct your attention to midfield, where the South Dakota Army National Guard is presenting today's game ball and a ceremonial coin for excellence for the championship game coin flip. The soldiers of the South Dakota National Guard salute today's players, coaches, and fans for exemplifying excellence in high school activities.
Deferred to the second half. The battlers decided they will receive on the south end. So flip around, please. So we'll receive down here. Good luck, man. Have a good one.
So the greedy, in the words of Coach Marty Borlock, Leola Frederick defense out on the field first, testing the Potter County Battlers, who will go from left to right. as we get things started here at the Dakota Dome. First of seven games going on in the 2013 State High School Football Championships. The Battlers and the Titans coming up with what should be an epic game if September 20th is any kind of indication, with a 12-7 final going the way of the visitors that night, Leola Frederick.
I don't know how many fans here from either team think it's going to be 12-7 as the final score. I think we're going to have a few more points on the board before all is said and done here, as Jimmy King gets it teed up for the Titans. They'll be in the dark uniforms, the Battlers and the Road Whites with the red helmets. Dalton Storer dropping back deep for the Battlers. And we are underway with the 9A championship game. That'll go to Hewer for the Battlers. Finds a little bit of a hole and pulled down. No, he stays on his feet. Gets to the 35-yard line.
A pretty return for Hewer. He was coming up the right sideline. Titans hit it, sealed off. He found an opening as he cut back inside and just refused to go down from there. Gettysburg will start in pretty decent field position on their first series off the right hash mark from its own 35-yard line at Potter County, instead of Gettysburg. Holman in there too, and here come the Battlers on offense.
Chase Hall leads the way, 984 yards passing, 53% on the season, 16 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. He has accounted for 26 touchdowns, 10 on the ground, with his 762 yards. He'll roll out to his right, being pressured, throws a long ball, got a man. Hewer's got it, and no one's going to catch him. First play, touchdown, Battlers.
Maybe not the typical M.O. of Potter County, although Chase Hall, a very good quarterback, he found a wide-open Tanner Hewer down the near sideline, hit him in full stride. Hewer went the rest of the way, 65-yard touchdown to get things started here in the 9A final.
Check it out on the replay. A nice throw on the run, perfectly placed. He beat the defensive back, Justin Helland, and it's a touchdown for Potter County. They normally go for two. That's what they'll do here. They'll line up with Hall running the option. Cuts to the middle of the field. He's going to be stopped. No two-point conversion, but nonetheless, the Battlers strike first and quickly, 6-0.
Went to fake the handoff on the option, then cut back inside. Net fooled for a second was Karsten Hurdle. Hurdle with the tackle, along with a couple of other Leola Frederick Titans. But the Battlers striking first, kind of sending a message that they will throw a lot of things while they have respect for Leola Frederick's defense, certainly. I don't think Vern Smith and the Battlers are afraid of that D at all.
A lot of times, teams will have different chemistry as far as what they're comfortable running later in the year as compared to earlier in the year. Maybe in the first game, you know, first or second game, you don't try a long pass on the first play from scrimmage. There you see the scoring drive. One play, only took 19 seconds, 65 yards. As the Battlers strike early. What an impressive throw by Chase Hall, the senior quarterback. And now the Titans will have to respond with their very potent offense. And they've got a pretty good quarterback in their own right in Dane Campbell, who's thrown for over 1,000 yards and 18 touchdowns on the season.
And I think this is a very important series for Leola Frederick. They need to build some confidence. Okay, you're down 6-0, but just 19 seconds gone to the game. Put together a nice drive. See what you can do against a team that you've seen earlier in the season. Just try to make some noise and get on the scoreboard.
Justin Helen drops back deep for the Titans as Chase Hall will tee it up, number 8 for the Battlers.
Logan Weiser back there too.
High end-over-end kick. It will sail down, and Weiser will take it. He's going to be tripped up by Colton Hall. Got away, but brought down by the Battlers near the 16-yard line.
And that is a fired-up Potter County squad over there. Weiser took the kickoff right at about the 5-yard line. Came running up the middle of the field. Gettysburg down there in a heck of a hurry and able to make the stop. So Leola Frederick's Titans with the ball at the 15-yard line as the Titans have their first offensive series against Potter County.
And they'll line up in a double wing set. Handoff goes to Weiser around the right side. Doesn't get much, maybe a yard if that.
One of the most important things an offense can do is make sure that the running back does not get the corner. Weiser took the handoff on a play that seemed a little bit slow to develop. He rolled toward that right side, and nothing doing as Potter County gave him the stop. Weiser does pick up one. It's second and nine.
Again, the double wing set, or actually they'll split the backs with one wing back. Handoff up the middle quickly. Drop for a loss. There's a fumble. Let's see who's got it. The Battlers have it as they went to one of, that was George Lopke, one of the backup running backs. Let's check it out on the replay here. Handoff up the middle. Lloyd Lopke lost it right there. Pounced on by the Battlers.
Yep, and a great defensive play because it was stripped right out of the hand of Lapke as he tried to find some room to the line of scrimmage. Battlers come up with it. Potter County football at the Leola Frederick 15.
That was Mitchell Hinckley with the fumble recovery for the team in white, and now they're deep in enemy territory. First down and 10. Hinckley, nothing doing.
Tried to get it off to the big fullback, 6'1", 200 senior Mitchell Hinckley. The Titans playing it perfectly as they just clogged the middle of the line as it went to the big guy. The Battlers will lose one. It is second down at 11.
Hinckley on the year, 5.7 yards a carry. No rushing touchdowns, but he has caught 14 passes, so he is a threat as a receiver as well. That'll be Colton Hall, the junior, deep in the eye set. Man of motion is Hewer, play action. Looking for Hewer, throws, no, they'll go to another receiver. That is Roush, he's got it. Touchdown, Battlers.
And that was kind of a pick your poison thing for Leola Frederick. He had one receiver, and that was Roush, who was going down the middle of the field, had his defender beat. Hewer wide open in the corner of the end zone, and it's just a matter of who he wanted to throw to, and here is the throw. Hall gets off just a beauty of a pass, finds Roush, there it is. And a big lead early for Potter County.
You see Hewer over there. He was open as well. And so 12-0. Now they'll try the point after kick. It is on the way. And that was Hall who kicked it, I believe. And that is good. Early, it's 13-0. Potter County. We're so used to seeing Gettysburg here in the past. But the Battlers jump out early on the Titans. 13-0. But it's still plenty early in this contest.
Absolutely, and Potter County scoring as they converted and capitalized on the turnover, able to strip the ball away from the running back, scored a couple plays later. Two play, 14-yard drive. This offense, nothing if not efficient. One play to score, then two plays to score, and took a grand total of 1 minute to get both touchdowns.
Don't forget our sports coverage continues next week with live coverage of the volleyball tournaments. We'll have all three tournaments online at sdpb.org beginning on Thursday, and then the third place and championship matches will be televised on all three channels. Class A will be on SDPB1, Class B will be on SDPB2, and Class AA on SDPB3 next Saturday. That'll be at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time. There you see the rundown, and of course all the preliminary matches leading up to Saturday night will be at sdpb.org.
And of course, sdpb.org is your source for statistical information during the football championships, along with photos and all the information you can handle.
High end over end kick. It'll go to Helen at the 10. Quickly downfield, and he's going to be wrapped up right away. Great special teams play by Dalton Storer, the junior.
Dalton Storer coming flying down there for the Battlers, and was able to just wrap his arms around Helland and bring him down. Leola Frederick starting its second series at the 18-yard line. There's Helland, tried to go one way, went the other, and just a beautiful tackle wrapped around, head for the waist. Low man wins.
That was a great tackle by Dalton Storer, and now the Titans, reeling a little bit, will go to the air, and they will not get a pass complete. That is incomplete, in and out of the hands of Derek Padal, the senior tight end. Had it for a moment, just couldn't hang on.
Padal was there. He had it left side, and if you're wondering why number 55 is an eligible receiver, the number requirements in nine-man football don't apply. So you can wear basically any number you want, and you can be a receiver or play any position. And now you see Padal going out again as he splits in the slot to the left.
And we'll have the spread formation here. Weiser in motion. The left-handed quarterback fires down the middle, tapped away, incomplete. Colton Hall, intended for Padal.
Right now, everything is working for Potter County. Colton Hall with a terrific job defensively. As he was working on Padal, they were trying to send him in the flat across the middle of the field. Rolled back, had that man in motion left side. There's the left-handed pass, and just swatted it away in perfect timing. Might not have been a complete pass anyway, because Padal did slip and fall on the turf. But at any rate, an incompletion. Third down and 10 for Leola Frederick.
Boy, the last thing they want to do is go three and out. Straight pass. There's a throw. Incomplete. Too far ahead of Padal. And, boy, everything going Potter County's
way. Pass is intended for Padal. And the Titans go three and out. They will kick it away. And here comes Jimmy King, who will give it up to the Potter County Battlers. Just a little bit thrown in front of him. He did get the right hand on the ball. Not able to get both in and haul it in. And Potter County will take the football. And you'd have to assume they'll get really good field position here.
Timeout. Blue.
Timeout called by Leola Frederick, as something wasn't right on their special teams unit. So, boy, things just going from bad to worse here for the team in the dark uniforms. Say, don't forget, on Saturday night, after the 11 AAA championship game, tune in for a special No Cover, No Minimum. We'll feature Cheryl Crow. SDPB recorded her performance this summer at Jazz Fest, presented by the Sioux Falls Jazz and Blues Society. So that will be coming up on Saturday night after the 11 AAA championship game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We expect it to be around 10 o'clock. It may go later, depending on how long the football game goes. But, you know, if you start recording your DVR at that time, give it a little extra time, or your VCR, whatever you may have. It's an amazing performance.
And if all you want to do is have some fun, catch that 11 triple, get that? Catch that 11 AAA championship game, and then Cheryl Crow on No Cover, No Minimum.
King with the punt for the Titan. Gets off a pretty good one. Chases Hewer back to his own 45, got a couple good blocks. And then he's brought down near midfield. So this is still good starting field position for the Battlers.
And that, more than anything, was a turf tackle. And that's the thing we talked about with Craig Maddock going into our pregame programming here. He just slipped, not used to the situation with the pro turf here that really isn't like any other field in the state. You get one chance to play it. You play indoors. And sometimes that just kind of combines for some slippage. 49-yard line of the Battlers is where Potter County will start.
Simon the back in the shotgun set. He'll go in motion. Hall looks to throw. Down the sideline, just beyond the reach of his wide receiver. Down there, I believe that was
Hayden Simon.
Hayden Simon.
Simon was headed down the far sideline, streaking toward the left, toward the Leola Frederick bench. The coverage was pretty decent that time on the part of Helen, but the ball just a bit overthrown. A catchable ball if it's another foot or so closer to him.
So the Battlers coming out throwing. Already two touchdown passes for Chase Hall, the senior. They'll line up in the I formation. Sundberg, the deep back. He'll get it. He's got room across midfield, close to the first down. He'll have the first down across the 40-yard line. That is Ryan Sundberg, senior running back.
Sundberg taking the handoff. You could really see the play develop on that near side as he rolled to the right. He took the pitch, coming to the right, and all kinds of room, plenty for the first down. Helland making the nice tackle there at about the 40, 39-yard line, and that's where Potter County starts its first play in Titan territory on this drive. And again, the Battlers with a 13-0 very early lead.
11-yard gain on that last play. Now Simon dots the eye. They'll send a man in motion. Handoff, Simon up the middle, cuts against the grain. Gets about 3 yards before he is brought down by Nathan Sumption for the Titans.
And that, more than anything, is it just, well, the guys are worn out. Let's take a bit of a break here. Nothing fancy, Dan, about it. Just gave the handoff to the running back, and he goes forward and gets his way to about the 36. So he picks up roughly 3 in the play. It'll be second down and 7 to go as Hayden Simon takes it from the tailback position and picks up 3.
Two backs now with Chase Hall, second man, going to get knocked in the backfield, and that'll be Mitchell Hinckley. He'll be thrown for a loss back near the original line of scrimmage.
Not fooled for 1 second. Matt Hoffman, 5'10", 180-pound senior. They misdirected into one side of the line, tried to send the running back Hinckley to the other, and again, not fooled. They go left, they come right, and here comes the tackle from Hoffman. Just wrapped him up, brought him down, and the Battlers lose two.
Yep, it'll be third down and nine. Back near the original line of scrimmage. Two receivers, checked at three receivers out to the left. Simon in the backfield, Hall rolls out to his left. Wants to throw, does throw. He's got a man too far, incomplete. Storer, the intended receiver.
Storer, the intended receiver, and some pretty good defense played by Weiser that time. Weiser coming out of the defensive backfield. They sent Storer along and just overthrowing a little bit. And you can see when the quarterback Hall misses for Potter County, he's missing long in the early going here.
Yep, and once again, Potter County throwing the deep ball. The thing is, their receiver did get behind the defensive back, and now Hall will line up in punt formation. Helen drops back deep.
Have to call us a very good defensive stand for the Titans.
A much needed defensive stand. Pooch kick towards the sideline. It will take a Gettysburg bounce. Let's see where this will be out of bounds inside the 20.
About the 13.
Well, they're going to march it forward at the 16 is where it will be out of bounds. 7:47 left, first quarter. Potter County up 13-0 on the Titans.
This is roughly where Leola Frederick has started every series today. They started one from the 18, were at the 20 at one point. Now they're going to start this offensive series from the 16, trying to climb out of the 13-0 hole with 7:47 in the first.
Send a man in motion, hand it off. Weiser, he'll get to the corner. Can he turn it? Not a whole lot. He'll get a decent gain on first down, about 4 yards.
Nice stop by Hewer as he came from his spot on the left side of the defense. Saw Weiser was going, and before he could get any serious yardage with the corner turned, Hewer was right there to make the stop. Second down, call it roughly 5 for Leola Frederick now.
And put the ball down at the 21. Again, the play clock here in the Dakota Dome is not on for the high school championships. They have to look at that referee downfield. Here's a run up the middle. They'll get a first down as Weiser gets the carry. And I believe that's the first down of the game for the Titans.
And every time that the Titans can pick up a first down or get a nice run of 4, maybe 5 yards a carry, that just builds their confidence. It shows them that they can do some things against this Battler defense. And an offense just gets stronger with the more success it has as the game goes on.
Yeah, and the Titans definitely needed to pick up a first down. They did not want to go 3 and out again. Handoff up the middle. This is Lopke, and he gets a good gain. 9 yards or so for a man who fumbled earlier, and that's got to be a confidence builder for George Lopke, who had 539 yards on the ground. 7.5 average, 6 touchdowns coming into this contest.
Real simple play. They sent Lepke up the middle. He twists and turns his way to a 9-yard gain, 2nd and 1.
Play action, rolling out as Campbell throws the long ball. Got a man in, complete. Padal, the intended receiver.
Padal, the slot receiver, usually to the left side. He was there, he was open, had the defenders beaten, but again, an overthrown ball that time around. It'll go to 3rd down and 1 for the Titans.
Padal came into this game, 25 catches, top receiver for the Titans. You see it on the replay, just beyond his grasp.
He made every effort to come up with it with the diving catch, and again, he had the defense beaten, but could not get the needle threaded.
3rd down. And they'll pick up the 1st down yardage. Move the chains, 1st down Titans. That was Campbell, the run.
They've really done a nice job of mixing up the run in the pass. They've thrown when they found it prudent. It hasn't been terribly successful for them through the air, but they're keeping that Battler defense honest, not knowing what to expect.
Titans will spread things out, 2 receivers either side. Send a man in motion, that's Weiser. Hand it off up the middle. Not much there for the running back. That was Karsten Hurdle. Came into the game with 276 yards, five touchdowns, 5.3 average.
Hurdle saw the original hole closed, and it was locked up pretty good, so he tried to veer to the left, and that's how he got the yard he got, and tripped up a little bit, then brought down by a couple of battler defenders right at the 45-yard line, or the 40, should say, and it's second down, nine to go.
Second and eight. And that time, Weiser just couldn't get going. Stopped near the line of scrimmage. No gain.
Hewer will take a tackle credit. Lucas Vogel will as well for Potter County. It's a play that they have run today, sending Weiser off the right side. That forces the left side of the Potter County defense, of course, to step it up. And they did. Third down. Fairly long situation here for Leola Frederick.
Misdirection play. Weiser trying to get to the corner. Oh, and a tackle in the open field by Tanner Hewer. Tripped up the running back. Very little gain.
The defensive end, Lucas Vogel, was trying to get there and stop the ball carrier. He was on the business end of a really beautiful block, but in the course of that, they forgot about Hewer, who was able to head left side, upend the ball carrier, fourth down, and the Titans will punt again.
Yep. Hewer's going to drop back deep, standing at his own 20. Jimmy King, the punter for the Titans. Gets away a line drive. This is returnable if it's a good bounce. Hewer has it. Gets a block to the 30. Pulled down near the 36-yard line.
Put all on the stop for Leola Frederick. And Potter County will have the ball. First and 10 at its 35.
Timeout on the field. 4:11 left. First quarter, 13-0. The Battlers leading the Titans will step aside for a moment.
Officials,
this is the 9A championship football
TV
game on
timeout.
South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. First quarter, Potter County out early on Leola Frederick, 13-0. Battlers have the football, first and 10 from their own 36 following a Titan punt. And they'll stack them up in the I formation. Hinkley goes in motion. Hand off Simon up the middle, gets about a yard. That's all.
Certainly meant to go farther on the play, but got wrapped up by, I think it was Padal who was in the area, and able to bring down the ball carrier, Simon, after just 1 yard. It'll be second down and about eight to go.
Padal has put up some great defensive numbers. 14 sacks, 74 tackles, 4 interceptions, 4 fumble recoveries. He's returned 2 of them for touchdowns, number 55 for the Titans. Play action. Paul throws from his back foot. He's got a man, but Helen is there, tips it away. Good coverage by Helen.
You want to learn how to play high school football, defensive back, take a look at that play. Helen, just a beautiful job covering Hewer. There's the pass coming toward the left side. It was right there in perfect timing. If you saw that, Helen just got his hand up at exactly perfect timing. No penalty at all. He didn't touch the body, and he was facing the football and came up with the swat away. It is third down and long now for Potter County.
Potter County has struck on a couple of touchdown passes. Play action, looking for a screen maybe. There it is, Simon has it. He's at the 40 to midfield, and he'll have a first down for the Battlers.
Beautiful offensive call there as Potter County keeps the ball, gets first down. They had a third and long situation, obviously a passing down. Hewer went out to somebody in the flat. That was Simon, who took the ball, did the rest of the work, and gets into Titan territory right at about the 49-and-a-half yard line. Close enough to the 50, but Potter County is still in business. 3:23 in the first.
Ryan Sundberg checks in, number 23. He'll be the tailback. Hinkley at fullback. Colton Hall, the wideout. Pitch, Sundberg tries the left side, got a couple of blockers. Spin around, and he'll get maybe about 3 yards. Following Carson Kirby.
Well, Sundberg had the blockers in front of him, but might have just gotten to the edge a little bit too late. And a nice job by Leola Frederick, making sure he didn't get any more than he did. He's got to pick up 4 yards regardless. Put the ball at the 46. It'll be second down and 6 for the Battlers, who lead it 13-0.
Storr will split out as a receiver to the left side. Double tight end set. Fullback dive. Hinkley muscles his way across the 45-yard line. Gets down near the... See where they'll spot him down. Around the 43.
Probably one of the simplest plays in football. You hand off to the big guy. He puts his shoulders down. You make sure he gets good blocking, which they did by the middle of the offensive line for Potter County. It'll bring up a third down 3 situation as the Battlers try to keep the ball moving and try to keep it in their possession late in the first.
It'll be Colton Hall, the wideout, to the left. Sundberg at fullback. He's trying to get a man in motion. That's Hinkley. Option play. Sundberg, he's going to be hit in the backfield. Tries to pull away. He is stopped. What a play. Padal by Derek Padal. Boy, there was something not right about that play as Hall was trying to get a man in motion and he kept tapping his foot. You know, that's the signal to the guy, go in motion. And
Hinkley had to get that message twice before he actually got in motion. That threw the entire timing of the play off, and just nowhere to go for the ball carrier. And look at that by Padal. Just incredible stick-to-itiveness in making the stop. It is fourth down and 10.
Padal was covering the quarterback, got to him quickly. Hall saw it, and I got to pitch the ball. And then Padal was able to read it and quickly get to the running back for a big loss. Off the side of the foot, not a very good punt by Chase Hall. And it's going to sail out of bounds. Wow, at the 45-yard line. That is a 5-yard punt by Chase Hall, who averages 39 and a half, but just shanked it off the side of his foot.
And that is a really good number for a high school kicker, to have a 39-yard punt average. There are college kickers who wouldn't mind that at all. Put the ball at the 44. Leola Frederick in some sort of business with a minute 12 and a half.
Yeah, this is the best field position the Titans have had. Let's see if they can capitalize. Oh, man in motion. That's going to be a penalty against Hurdle.
First one of the game.
Yeah, pretty clean played first quarter of football so far. Let's hope we haven't jinxed ourselves.
Right, and the illegal procedure, as you see, indeed the call. That will go on the Titans, put them back to the 39-yard line where it will be first and 15. Coming up a little bit later today, the 9AA contest. That will feature Arlington.
Still first down.
Sorry, sir. On Arlington and Bridgewater, Emory, Ethan. Tonight, the 11AA championship game, 7:30 kickoff here at the Dome. Madison and West Central, the Bulldogs, unbeaten, looking for their first ever state championship in football.
West Central comes in at 9-2. They played a 3-point game earlier this year. That's Weiser in motion, misdirection play. Not much there for the running back, Evan Emery, the senior. And he's brought down at the line of scrimmage, no gain.
Job that time for the Gettysburg defense was just to string it out as best they could. Emery had nowhere to go as he took the handoff right away. It's coming left side, shaking off one of the Battlers, and then here comes basically the rest of the Potter County defense to bring him down, no gain. And it'll be second and 15.
Credit Carson Kirby for initially breaking up that play, and then Vogel and the rest of the Potter County Battlers were there. Here's a handoff, wide running play. Weiser gives ground, penalty flag is down, and this one may be coming back as Weiser brought down at about the 46-yard line. Boy, that play did not start well for the Titans.
One would have to think that that is going to be a holding call that is going in Leola Frederick, and here is the signal. There was a pretty obvious case of holding going on the right side toward what we would consider to be the far sideline, as one of the defenders for Potter County had a chance at the running back, but stopped via the hold, and that will bring the football back 10 yards from the spot.
Yep, it's from the spot of the infraction. Let's get the word from our referee.
Holding, blue, 10-yard penalty, still second down.
And again, it's not from the line of scrimmage. It's from the spot of the infraction. So this one's going all the way back to the 30-yard line. Second down and very long coming up for the Titans. They've got to get all the way to Potter County's 45-yard line, essentially, for a first down. But all goes in motion. Little pump fake, throws. He's got a man. It's over the shoulder of Weiser, incomplete. He was looking for the ball over his right shoulder. It went over his left shoulder. He had to spin and change direction and just couldn't catch up with it.
And that'll happen quite a bit with an overthrown football. He's looking right shoulder. You lose it a little bit there, then go over the left saying, is it there? And by that time, too late to really do anything. And for the Titans, they were given very good field position on the 5-yard punt that time. And just not able to do much with it. They had a couple of penalties in here, and now they are third and deep. They are third and 25 to go for a first down.
They've got some big player receivers. Let's see if they can get him the ball. Campbell has time, throws the long ball, and it's incomplete, intended for Weiser at the 40-yard line.
Basically the same play that they ran last time, and roughly the same result as Weiser. Looking over the right shoulder, should have been there on the left. Had the defender about a half step on the defender.
That was Colton Hall, number 3. There's the ball, nice spiral thrown. And again, just beyond the fingertips.
Just not quite there for the Titans, and they will go to fourth down and 25.
Jimmy and King out there to punt. He averages 37 yards per attempt. And that's Hewer back deep for the Battlers. Not much pressure. Gets away a pretty good punt over the head of Hewer. He'll let it bounce and roll. Will he pick it up? Yes, he will at the 9-yard line. Looking for some blocks. Gets to the sideline. Turns the corner, but too many blue jerseys there. And will end the first quarter of play at the 22-yard line. This is the 9A championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We're back. 61-yard punt there by Jimmy King. And there you see Hewer on the return. Gets to the sideline, stops. Just caught up in too much traffic. Pulled down.
And that could have gone a heck of a lot worse for Potter County, too. He took that back in the neighborhood of the 5-yard line, and there were people coming. Not a lot of hang time on the punt, but it just rolled enough that gave the Titans room enough to head down there. He picks up yardage to about the 23-yard line. And again, that could have gone worse for Potter County.
Yep, nice play by Hewer, who's had a good game so far. Potter County with the lead in the football. Period number 2 underway here at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. I'm Steve Toome along with Gary Ellenbolt, Craig Maddock along the sidelines. Mike Henriksen will join us later today for the first of 3 days of football. 7 games in all. Shotgun set. Colton Hall and Chase Hall. Chase Hall will keep it. He'll be stacked up 3 yards behind the line of scrimmage.
Just nowhere to go for him as Padal and a couple of others were able to clog things up, drive him straight back, and wrap up the tackle. The Battlers will lose 3. It'll be second down and 13 from the 20-yard line.
What do we got for stats?
First quarter stats, 4 first downs for Potter County, 2 for Leola Frederick. 92 yards on the ground for Potter County compared to none for the Titans through the air. It was 92 yards, I should say, passing. Total offense, 14 plays, 106 yards for Potter County. And the Titans, 16 plays for 25 yards.
Second down and long. Chase Hall rolls out, has time, throws the long ball. He's got a man, and it is caught by Hewer. Can he pull away from Helen? Touchdown, Battlers! 80-yard pass completion for Potter County.
And that was anything but an easy catch for Hewer. Had his defender beaten to the point, the defender, Helen, was out of bounds. There's the long pass. They decide to go for the home run on second and long. He comes up with it, keeps his feet somehow, turns around, and goes all the way to the end zone. Just outracing number 7, Helland, for Leola Frederick. It's a 19-0 lead now for Potter County's Battlers, and here they come for the extra point.
Let's see if they'll line up for the two-point conversion. They will. They'll have the eye set with Simon at tailback. Roll out by Hull. Pumps. Has to go back. Pumps again. Runs into a crowd and no good on the two-point conversion. But Potter County jumping out to a 19-0 advantage here early in the second quarter of play.
Jimmy King and Padal on the stop on the two-point conversion. Individual statistics. Ryan Sundberg leading Potter County with 12 yards on three carries, or his longest was 12. He had 9 yards, excuse me. Hayden Simon with 6. Mitchell Hinckley minus 1 yard. Logan Weiser leading Leola Frederick with 13 yards on 5 carries. Dane Campbell 0 for 6 passing. Chase Hall 3 for 6. And again, with the new touchdown from Potter County. And Hewer, his second of the game, it's 19-0 Battlers with the two-play 77-yard drive going 1 minute.
I'm looking here for yards receiving. Nick Hofer of Canastota had 2012 at 195 yards receiving. That is the individual record. There was just 80 more for Hewer, so he may have a chance to break that record. Yards passing, 294, Cody Bunger of Canastota in 2012.
And you know, anyone worried about the attention span of today's youth should take a look at Mr. Hewer there. What concentration he had to look the pass into his hands. He caught it, had to keep his balance while thinking, okay, I've got to catch this. He got that done and raced into the end zone for the score. Great play.
And Hewer's had some good tackles on defense as well. He's playing a standout game. Tanner Hewer, 5'7", 150-pound senior. And Chase Hall hung in and threw that pass down the field under heavy pressure. Helen on the return from the 10. Gets wrapped up. Boy, the special teams unit for Potter County has been stellar in this first half.
Scott Gloat making the stop. He's a 6 foot, 170-pound senior, just wrapping up Helland and bringing him down. And Leola Frederick starting in another deep hole. First down and 10 from the Titans' 19-yard line, and they're trailing 19-0.
That's the way to go out there, kick team. Good job, Chris.
Been a good morning of football so far, as we're coming up just a few minutes away from high noon on the east part of the state. Still an hour to go till noon out in the west part of the state. My name's Steve Toon, Gary Allen Bull here. Craig Maddock joining us. He's from KWSN Radio in Sioux Falls. He's on the sidelines for this first contest as the Titans will give it to Weiser. Nice through traffic, slips a couple of tackles, gets to the 30. Good gain on first down, should be enough for a Titan first down.
And that is a play that Leola Frederick likes to run a lot, send somebody around the corner. Weiser with the speed to get there, and that time had some good blocks around him. Here he comes, veered inside off that nice block, then takes a step to the outside, knows where he has to be, runs out of bounds at the 30, and that'll mean a first down for Leola Frederick.
First and 10, right at the 30-yard line. They'll put a man in motion, hand up the middle. Nice gain for Hurdle out to the 40-yard line. Should have another first down for Leola Frederick. Way too early in the game for Leola Frederick to just abandon the run game and go all pass.
Absolutely, and that's the thing that has gotten them through this entire season. Unbeaten coming into the contest. It's just a matter of chewing up some time, get on the scoreboard eventually, but you can't make up 19 points on one play. So you have to do what you're good at and capable of.
Weiser in motion, Hurdle up the middle, short gain on the play. Simon there to bring him down along with Sundberg for the Battlers.
And again, just a simple play up the middle. You give it to the guy, lower the shoulders, and Hurdle picks up about 3 more yards. Second down and 7 after 2 consecutive first downs with Leola Frederick having the ball at its own 43.
Second, call it 7. Handoff up the middle. Lopke with the ball. No gain. Sundberg and Hinckley.
And Carson Kirby getting in there as well. Carson Kirby finishing off the job. They get nothing, and a tough situation for the Titans at 3rd down and 7.
Don't forget, you can follow SDPB Sports on your mobile device all season long. Go to SDPB Sports. Hook up with us on Facebook and Twitter. Roll out by Campbell. Throws under pressure, overthrows his receiver, and Hall levels the intended receiver, Emery, incomplete.
It was going to be an incomplete pass anyway. It was well past Emery, but sending a little message was Hall on the third down and seven play. Now goes to fourth down and seven, and Jimmy King is out there for the apparent punt for Leola Frederick.
King only punted 19 times on the season, and he's been a frequent visitor so far here in this first half. 9:33 left, second quarter. Battlers have been in control as Hewer drops back deep. There you get a look at King. High snap, but he corrals it. Not much pressure and a good punt away. Hewer sidesteps a man at the 15, runs into his own guy, and is finally brought down near the 25-yard line.
So Hewer slips away from one tackler, and then here's a guy in a white jersey just kind of colliding. I mean, it wasn't an intentional play, certainly, because they'd never do that. Watch as he comes down the field.
Whoops.
Slips at first and then runs into his own man and kind of gets tied up. That gives the Titans defense, or kicking team, enough time to get down there. So 60 or 75 yards away from another score, the Potter County Battlers taking the ball at their own 25.
First down, Battlers. In the road white uniforms. Handoff, Hewer on the reverse, stuffed, dropped for a loss.
Lapke on the tackle as he was in the backfield very early and was able to wrap himself around the ball carrier and bring him down. Now Padal leaving the field seems to be favoring his right hand or right arm a little bit, Steve.
Yeah, he'll be replaced by Jimmy King, and Padal, one of those key players, again, 74 tackles, 14 sacks, a couple fumble recoveries for touchdowns. He is one of the key weapons on offense and defense for the Titans. Hopefully he's okay. I formation, Hall wants to throw. Throws under pressure, got a man caught by Storer, first down.
Storer making the diving catch for the first down. Roughly at the 45, 46-yard line. They went left side. He was looking for somebody to get open and then finally found Storer on the left. Had a couple of steps on the defenders. Makes the diving catch at the 46, first down and 10, Potter County.
It looked for a moment that Hall would tuck and run, but then he saw the man open, fired the ball downfield. Didn't have his feet set, but still got it to him. A nice little spiral. Eye set. Colton Hall, the deep back. Fakes. Throws. Caught. Hall gets a block. Turns the corner at midfield. He's at the 40. Cuts back to the 30. Can Weiser catch him? Yes, he will. Inside the 20-yard line. He's out of bounds at the 15. Little screen pass. It works for Potter County.
Just an awesome call there on first down from the 46. Sent the receiver, Hall, to the right side. There's the quick screen, comes up with the catch. Nice catch as the ball was sailing over him. Gets some beautiful yardage afterward. There's the cutback inside. Weiser, the last time guy out with a shot, and Blue. Got it done. A timeout call by Leola Frederick. They're going to talk things over with Marty Morlock. It is first down and 10 for the Battlers at the Leola Frederick 15.
And don't forget, our sports coverage will continue next week with live coverage of the South Dakota High School Volleyball Championships. All the tournament action will be online at sdpb.org beginning on Thursday, 1 week from today, that's the 21st. The third place in championship matches from every tournament will be on all three SDPB television channels next Saturday night. Here's the Gettysburg Huddle.
Interior guys. And what a great opportunity that is to see a lot of volleyball. Here are some of the past 9A champions. You look at a couple of dynasties there. Canastota, Hanson had a couple of consecutive championships. Hanson again in 2005.
Avon.
A town that's near and dear to your heart for some reason. Scotland with a couple of titles. And Scotland played 500 football going into the playoffs that first year. Did they not?
They did. They were 4-4, had some injuries, but some of their key players got healthy. Scotland also doing well in track and field and basketball at that time. Had a core of great athletes. So you look, Avon is in there. Northwestern had a good team. Canastota, of course, just dominant 3 years in a row in 9B and 9A. Hanson, always tough in football. Some great traditional programs there in 9A over the past decade.
I think it's really important for the Titans to keep Potter County out of the end zone.
Colton Hall with the carry, penalty flag down.
Not sure what the flag would be about as it was thrown toward the pile in the area of the tackle at the 13-yard line.
Yep, holding the call, so this will back up the Battlers.
That's the first penalty on Potter County in the game. They lead it here 19-0, 8 minutes and 9 seconds to go in quarter number two.
And you're right, this is such an important defensive sequence for Leola Frederick. Let's get the official word.
Holding, White, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Still first down.
There you see on the replay, there's the hold right there. I think they're going to tag Aaron Beach, the senior guard. Moves the ball back to the 20, in between the 25 and the 26.
And now Leola Frederick not only has to stop them, but take advantage of this break they've been given on the penalty.
Play action. Got a man. He's open but overthrown. The intended receiver was Michael Roush. The pass overthrown.
Might have been a bit of miscommunication as Roush was on the right side of the end zone. The ball throw more toward the middle. An incompletion at any rate. It will be second down and 20 to go with the ball at the 26-yard line of Potter County.
8:04 left until halftime. Ryan Sundberg checking in to the Battler lineup. At a running back position, they'll interchange Simon, Colton Hall, and Sundberg. Will the Battlers. Now Chase talking to his running backs. That is Hinkley and Sundberg, and they might have taken. Are they going to call timeout? Yep.
Battlers timeout. Will call timeout.
Yep, Battlers will call timeout.
White.
That is the first charge timeout for Potter County.
And the Battlers with a little bit of thinking to do here on a second down and 20 situation. They can get the first down without getting a touchdown. They would have to get to the Titans' 5-yard line, though. Plenty of time to do it with 8:04 in quarter number two here from the Dome.
And I know both you and I have slipped up and mentioned Gettysburg for Potter County, but we want to talk about a program that we're going to have coming up on Sunday, the 17th. It's the premiere of the Gettysburg story. 150 years later, America's greatest battle is recounted as you've never seen it before. The Gettysburg story provides a unique bird's eye view of the Gettysburg National Military Park. That's on Sunday in the afternoon at 3 Central, 2 Mountain Time. I've had a chance to see this program. If you're a Civil War buff, you have to see this program. It is incredible. Stephen Lang, the famed actor, does the narration. He played General Pickett in that Gettysburg movie a number of years ago. And he does the narration for that. It's a wonderful program. Again, Sunday the 17th at 3 Central, 2 Mountain Time on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Just another service that we offer, an opportunity to learn a lot here on public TV.
Potter County sends a man in motion. That's Hewer. Straight drop back. Pressure. Throwing on the run. And it's Hewer again. Touchdown, Potter County.
Helen just had no way to go as the ball looked to be overthrown for a second. Hewer put on the speed as the ball was coming to him. He was able to run under it. Hewer now with his third score of the day for Potter County. There's the pass. Weiser gets blocked out. Nice spiral coming to Hewer right there. Helen just didn't have another thing he could do.
And I think on every touchdown pass so far for the Battlers, their receiver's been past the last defender as the Battlers will line up and go for two. Fumble on the snap. Hall will just cover it up and no good on the two-point conversion attempt. But nonetheless, the Battlers on top of the Titans, 25-0. And wow, what a first half effort by Potter County.
Really the only thing that they have not mastered in this game are the two-point conversions. They did kick after their second touchdown, the one that went to Roush, but they've tried three two-point conversions after that. Potter County has failed on each one.
There's the drive, five plays. Boy, that's a long drive for Potter County the way they've been scoring today.
Today it is, yeah.
Minute 25, time of possession. You know, back in 1863, Abraham Lincoln proved himself a master of a new frontier with his high-tech command center, the War Department Telegraph Office, America's first situation room. It's on the 150th anniversary of his famous Gettysburg Address. We'll have a program called Lincoln at Gettysburg. It describes a major turning point in America's history, the rebirth of a nation and the dawn of the information age. That'll be on the 19th. That's Tuesday night at 8 Central, 7 Mountain Time on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. You mentioned earlier the educational programming. We have so many great history documentary and history shows on public broadcasting. We stack up, and I think we have the best lineup of historical programs anywhere on television. Helen retreats to his own six to take the kickoff. Gets a block, gets to the 30. He's got room, and he's tackled by the last man in line. That's Storer for Potter County. But a good return by Helen.
And Helen has had a tough day, especially in the defensive secondary. He's able to get the kickoff. He comes toward the near sideline, able to skirt his way around several of the Potter County squad. Here he comes with the neon green gloves, switches hands nicely, protecting the football. Gets away from a bunch of people. Storer, the last guy back there, the last hope for a stop, and he got it done.
Titans down by 25, and they'll go with Emery. He tries to turn the corner. He'll get to midfield, and Chase Hall will move him out of bounds. Nice gain on first down for the Titans.
That was a very nice play for Leola Frederick as they go on the first play. Pitch to the left side, and Emery able to get the 7-yard gain. Well, we'll call it 8. Second down and a couple yards to go in a very long-lasting second quarter here, Steve.
It has generally moved along pretty quickly, but it's taken a little more time here in this second quarter. Handoff. That goes to Hurdle. Karsten Hurdle up the middle. Got enough for a first down.
Here on the stop for Potter County, it was just a simple, basic play, one of the simplest, most basic plays in football. Just a handoff up the gut, rely on the blockers, got him enough yardage for the first down, and you'll put the ball at the Potter County 45.
This is only the second time this year that anybody has gotten over 20 points against this Titan defense. Man in motion, but it's going to be a handoff up the middle, and getting tripped up is George Lopke.
And Lopke trying to go up the middle. He was tripped up right away. Did all he could do to pick up the 1 yard. And Carson Kirby on the stop for Potter County. The Battlers and the Titans get back at it with Leola Frederick in a 2nd-and-9 situation.
Chase Hall for Potter County already is accredited with 258 yards of passing. The record's 294. Quick pass, but all finally has a catch. Slips past a couple of men. First down, Titans. All the way to the 25-yard line.
First completed pass of the day for Leola Frederick, and Padal just about dropped that one. It was a tough catch for him. It was behind him a little bit. Had to turn his body and come up with the grab. You see the man in motion, the grab by Padal as he turned around some nice yards after the catch as well.
And now the Titans driving down the field, their best drive of the day. They put a man in motion, handed off the Hurdle up the middle. He'll crash ahead. Get about 3 yards, maybe 4.
Wanted to give the offense a bit of a break after the pass play. Scott Gloat on the stop for Potter County. It will be a gain of roughly 5. Second down, 5 or 6 to go. Ball at the Potter County 25, or 20.
Titans need points on this drive as they're down by 25 points. Needless to say, it's their biggest deficit they've faced this year. Is Weiser upended, but he gets to about the 14-yard line. That should be enough to move the chains for the Titans.
Started out outside, took a step to the inside, and was able to get the chains moved. Indeed they would, as he goes in motion, takes the handoff, takes a quick cut inside, and gets to the 14, just enough for the first down, but he got it done. First and 10, Leola Frederick with the serious threat here halfway through the second quarter.
Under 6 minutes to go, first half. Titans in the dark uniforms, Potter County in the road whites. Campbell drops back, faces some pressure, throws incomplete, in and out of the hands of Derek Pottle.
And he was there on the left side as it was at about the 8-yard line. The defense, that time by Hayden Simon in the backfield, but just a drop ball there. Second down 10.
Four down territory, no doubt, for Leola Frederick. Jimmy King does have one field goal on the year for 38 yards, but the Titans need to get 6 points out of this drive, not three. They'll put a man in motion, handoff up the middle. Lopke crashes into a couple of white jerseys, and he will get maybe a couple of yards.
Give George Lopke this. He just refused to go down. Some pretty good tackles and some big defenders there for Potter County, but Lopke refusing to go down. Picked up a couple of yards for the effort. It'll be a third down, 8 situation as Leola Frederick has it at the Battler 13.
Emery will be in the backfield. Well, they'll go with the full house backfield first time today, and they'll send Weiser out to the right. He'll be tripped up. He'll stumble ahead, get 2 yards.
Very close to losing yardage that time as Hewer was able to make it into the backfield, but just got past the ball carrier Weiser. It'll be a fourth down situation. They have a pretty decent field goal kicker in Jimmy King. If that's the route they decide to go, not the 3 points will help a lot, but it would be something. Fourth down, 7 to go. They will try to go for the first down. They need to get to the 4.
Dane Campbell went over on the sideline to get a play from Coach Marty Morlock. Big play here for the Titans. Fourth down and about 7. They'll spread things out. Lopke the lone back. Campbell has time. He'll throw. He's got a man. Touchdown. Logan Weiser.
Logan Weiser with a great catch as he caught that off his hip. He was just into the end zone. The ball came to him. Had to turn, trap it against the right hip, and in he came. It's the first score of the game for Leola Frederick. They're a long way from out of it, but some work to get back into it. 25-6 is the score. And now the conversion attempt for the Titans.
That was a huge, huge score. The Titans absolutely needed to get that goose egg off the scoreboard. Now they'll line up for 2. Split out 4 wide receivers. Send a man in motion. That's Weiser. Campbell rolls out, faces pressure, throws, and it's going to be in the hands of Lopke. Did he get there?
He
yes.
Looked like he bobbled the ball as soon as Gettysburg's Hayden Simon got there, but he was able to get past the pylon, and it's a 25-8 score. Here's a replay of the touchdown. Now look at what Weiser had to do to come up with the grab and the score. Had it trapped right against the hip and turned in and got the score. The PAT good, 25-8 the score.
We'll take a timeout. This is the Class 9A championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Back at the 9A championship football game, there you see that last scoring drive by the Titans. 10 plays, 56 yards, 3:47 time of possession. It makes it 25-8 in favor of Potter County. I'm Steve Toome along with Gary Ellenbolt and Craig Maddock. A huge drive by Leola Frederick there to get some points before halftime.
And it probably wasn't realistic to expect a shutout of Leola Frederick, but what a beautiful drive they came up with. They made catches where they had trouble doing that throughout the game, able to get some nice runs, chewed up some time on the clock, which isn't terribly hurtful early enough in the game, and now they get on the board, 25-8. They're trailing, 4:11 left.
Onside kick, and it's corralled right away by Kirby, and he was ready for it. He'll get to the 45. I was just about to say, I wonder if the Titans are going to try an onside kick.
And there it was, Clayton Kirby right there to get his hands on the ball and go forward. Remember, it was a few years ago, and I think in the 9A game, we saw somebody score on an onside kick who was coming the other way. I think it was Canastota.
I believe so. It was Carson Kirby that time for Potter County. Corralled that onside kick and manages to give Potter County really good field position at the Titan 45-yard line. They've got 2 timeouts left and 4:07 to work. Big stand coming up here for the Titan defense. They can't afford to give another touchdown. Back to Potter County. Hall rolls out, looking, throws off his back foot. He's got a man, it's caught, and it'll be Mitchell Hinckley, and it's a touchdown. That may give Hall the passing record here in the first half. He had 258, that goes for 45. He's at, what, 303?
He's at 303 now, and he has a new record for passing yardage, and did this in the first half.
Check out the replay. Watch Hall scan over the field, look to his right, then back to his left. Floats it downfield. Mitchell Hinckley, the fullback. He was a threat coming in with three touchdown catches total on the season, 14 receptions coming into this game. And just like that, the Battlers make it 31-8. Again, they score in one play. Simon the deep back as Hall rolls out. Looking to throw, he does, and it is going to be incomplete. Simon just couldn't collect it, but nonetheless, the Battlers score a quick touchdown again, 31-8.
And there was a pretty good amount of pressure on the part of the Leola Frederick defense that time. Lapke just about brought down Chase Hall. Hall got rid of it just at the instant he had to and found Hinckley wide open for the score. One play drive, 45 yards, 13 seconds to get it done. We are at 31-8, Potter County with the lead over Leola Frederick, and now the Battlers will kick the football away again.
Yep, and for the Titans, well, they'll have a lot of time to work with, just one timeout, but with nearly 4 minutes on the clock, they've got a good opportunity to get more points on the board, and for the Titans, that is so very key at this stage of the game to get some more points on the board before halftime, because Leola Frederick will have the football to start the third period of play.
You know, the onside kick came back to bite the Titans, but I like the call. You know, yeah. Just try to cross up Potter County a bit, but just a matter of Potter County coming up with the football, scoring a play later, but you have to like the fact that they gave it a shot.
Yeah, I agree with the chance to try to make something happen here, but credit the Battlers. They were ready for the onside kick, and then they throw another deep pass and get another touchdown, as that will be Chase Hall lining it up to kick off. There you see a Logan Weiser back deep, the junior tailback. One of the best in the state. And Hall will kick it deep. And that'll send Helen back to his own three. And he is met and brought down at the 20-yard line.
Michael Roush came in, coming up with the tackle. The best tackles are the ones you hear. And that time, you heard the collision between Helen and Roush. Here it comes. It comes up the right side. Number 14 coming up right there. Shoulder pad to shoulder pad, hauling him down. You really like, and this has been a point of emphasis in football, especially at the high school level. You don't see the helmet-to-helmet contact at all, or really close to it all anymore. That time just shoulder-to-shoulder, got the head to the side. Very nice form on the tackle for Rowe.
And credit, Potter County's special teams play has been outstanding in this game as Campbell drops back. Scott all day to throw, over the middle. Got a man, it's Weiser. He escapes to the 40, to the midfield. First down, Titans.
Critical made by Colton Hall out of the defensive backfield. Weiser had a long time to run and was wide open to come up with the reception. Close to busting it. The left-handed quarterback looking to throw. Gets it over the middle. Weiser there. He got around the defender at first. Then when he had to hurdle another defender, that gave Hall time enough to make the grab.
Campbell drops back. Three-man rush. Pass floated over the head of the receiver. Incomplete. Intended for Austin Herner, the senior tight end.
And that was very good coverage that time. Ryan Sundberg coming off the linebacking spot. Hewer in the area as well. And they were between the intended receiver who just couldn't get it done at second and 10.
Sundberg, senior linebacker, credited with 117 tackles. Coming into this game, number two on the team behind Mitchell Hinckley, who is credited with 125 tackles for the Battlers. Second and 10. Still a lot of time left, 3:28 in the second quarter. Out of the shotgun. Campbell, oh, he's under pressure. He escapes. He'll run. Flips a man, upended. Got about 4 yards, maybe five on the scramble.
I don't know how in the world he avoided the sack. He had battlers on either side of him. He kind of split the uprights with them, and Dane Campbell not only made both of them miss, they kind of ran into each other. There that goes. Campbell coming right, coming up the middle, and getting nice yardage to the 45. Picks up five for the first, or a third down now, and five.
Sundberg on the tackle for Potter County. As the Titans approach the line, they'll spread out the receivers, two to either side. Hurdle stays in the backfield with Campbell. Padal goes in motion. Campbell under pressure, throws, has a man. Weiser pulls it down at the 22. What a great catch.
An incredible catch by Weiser as he had Colton Hall right there. Hall played it pretty nicely in the defense, but Weiser able to make the great catch around Hall. And a first down well into Potter County territory. There's the grab, the leaping catch. Nice one by number 28 Weiser. It is first down and 10 at the Potter County 22.
And credit Campbell. He took a little bit of a shot right after he delivered the ball. He stood tall in the pocket and delivered a strike. First down, Titans. Lopke, the lone setback, four wideouts. We'll put a man in motion. That's Weiser. Campbell, quick throw. Put it all over the middle. Has it. Spins away. He'll rumble into the end zone. Touchdown, Titans.
Just refused to go down as he had Sundberg just about set to tackle him at the five-yard line. Beautiful spin move at the five. And Podol comes up with the touchdown. It's a 31-14 game on the 22-yard pass play. There goes Weiser in motion. Campbell's throw. Now look at this move. Sundberg comes. He spins around, shakes two battlers, able to outrace everybody, Chase Hall, etc., into the end zone. And there's the touchdown.
Eighth touchdown catch of the year for Derek Padal. And now the Titans line up, and they'll go for two out of the shotgun set. Campbell rolls, throws on the run. Padal has it. Is he in? Yes, he is. The two-point conversion good for Leola Frederick. And now the complexion of this game has changed. Still a two-score game, but it's 31-16 in favor of the Battlers.
I think Marty Morlock might be sorry to see the second period end now, because Leola Frederick has been able to do some things that just eluded them in the first quarter. Five-play 30-yard drive for, or 80-yard drive, excuse me, for Leola Frederick. Took him a minute 47 to score, and they are really working and having found their land legs here in the first half. It took probably a good quarter and a half to get them going, but they proved to themselves, if nothing else, they can move the ball on Potter County.
Exactly. Leola Frederick's offense was not really in sync in that first quarter. Potter County jumped out to the huge lead. It was 25-0 at one point. Now, still a hole for the Titans to climb out of, but at least they can see some daylight. For Potter County, interesting thing here. Of course, you probably want to watch for the onside kick again. I don't suspect that will happen. But nonetheless, for Potter County, you'll have a couple of minutes to work with and two timeouts. Now, they could just run out the clock or maybe try to go downfield again. We shall see. But first, the kickoff has to happen by Jimmy King.
They have shown a big play offense before. They haven't needed a lot of time to score on most of their drives today.
King approaches, and he'll send it deep. And it goes on a fake reverse. It's Storr with the ball. He's got some blocks, and Helen brings him down across the 40 near the 43-yard line.
Leola Frederick bit on that fake just enough for Potter County to make some pretty serious noise on it. And they get to the 45-yard line in very good field position with 2:04 to go.
That's a great fake there by Storr as he tucks it and runs, and they'll put the ball down just shy of the 44-yard line. First down, Battlers. See what they do in the remaining 2:04 of the second quarter. And remember, the Titans will get the ball to start the third period. And now Leola Frederick, they have just spent their third timeout. So Marty Morlock must have saw something with this defense that he didn't like. So he spends his third and final timeout.
Good idea to spend the holidays with SDPB on Thanksgiving. SDPB will highlight the talented musicians from South Dakota in the Elementary Honor Choir and High School Chorus and Orchestra concerts in December. Specials featuring a favorite group of mine, Tonic Solfa, also Celtic Women, the Mormon Tabernacle Choir, and South Dakota's own Haig Brothers, plus lots more. What a great lineup for the holidays from SDPB.
You get a look at the Potter County huddle.
Let's go a little bit wide on it. Will that work? To fake the option.
As you hear Vern Smith giving some of the instructions to Potter County, they've got 56 yards to reach the end zone, 2 minutes and 4 seconds to do it. If there's a team that can pull that off, particularly today, the way they've played, it's the Badgers.
Yeah, the way their offense has been rolling in the first half, they've had several drives of one play and two plays. Don't forget, you can purchase a DVD copy of any of the high school championship football games. Call 1-800-456-0766 or go online at sdpb.org. The DVD copy is $19.95. $5 for shipping and handling. If you're a member of the Friends, we'll waive that. Here's a rollout. Hall, pump fakes, throws, got a man wide open at the 30, the 20, the 10. Touchdown, Potter County, Lucas Vogel. His seventh touchdown catch of the year.
Everybody wants to get into the act. Took one play, 56 yards, as Chase Hall continues to pad the passing yardage record for one half, certainly for a game. He pump fakes. That got the Leola Frederick defense to hesitate for a minute. Vogel just out racing everybody. That was quite a foot race. Weiser had a shot at him, a couple of other players as well. It is wide open now for the Battlers. Potter County leading at 37-16. And they'll try for the 1 point PAT here. They have failed on every conversion this afternoon / morning here in Vermilion.
Hewer the holder. The kick is on the way. It hits the Pepsi sign and it is good. Generally, if you hit the Pepsi sign, that means it's good, because I think it's about the length of the goalpost there at the that end of the Dakota Dome. What a first half explosion. And, you know, Chase Hall, well over 300 yards. In fact, he's probably over 350 as far as the offense goes. We'll have to check.
Well, he was at 303. We had him for 303, and then that went 56 yards. So
he's over 350.
He's
and
pushing
now,
360 now.
You know, Chase Marceau for Brandon Valley set some records last year. Chase Hall may shatter those. After that 11-AA game last year, I thought, well, my goodness, you know, that performance from Chase Marceau, that's going to stand for a while.
All
it
of a year?
It may not, folks. I mean, we are seeing a clinic being put on by Potter County here. All classes, individual records. Oh, no, this is for 11-man. Well, this is for 11-man here. And I know that has to be Chase Marceau for yards passing. Yeah, 454 last year for Brandon Valley.
And the way that Potter County's playing, Hall isn't that far away.
No, unofficially, he's probably only about 100 yards off, and we still have another half of football to go. What a great performance here by Potter County, a team you don't think of necessarily as a passing offense. For 9-man, Corey Jacobson of Viberg-Hurley had 400 yards a few years ago. Here's a kickoff downfield. It'll bounce near the 20, picked up by Weiser. And some good special teams coverage again as Weiser rumbles ahead to the 33. That performance by Jacobson was back in 2010. What a standout athlete he was.
Oh, yeah.
For Viberg-Hurley.
We covered that game, in fact,
mm-hmm.
as Viberg-Hurley was in action, I believe, against Avon.
I don't remember if that was Avon. We'll check it up here really quick.
All right. And we're going to get a statistical update. He has the record and then some, we would think. And Tyler Ulrich has a record, or had the record, for 5 touchdowns and a half. That was for Lyman in 2007. And 359 yards is the official total now for Hall.
Weiser with the catch across midfield. He'll slip a man to the 40. Cuts back. Still on his feet. Still on his feet. Down inside the 30-yard line.
That was right out of the movies as the circus catch made by Weiser. He was falling off balance, able to make the grab. He hauled it in, just about gets out of bounds, gets away from Colton Hall. And then here he comes toward the middle of the field, breaks one tackle, couple more coming. There's a second, a third, a fourth, another guy with the opportunity, and that time finally brought down.
Handoff up the middle. Hurdle won't get much there. Remember, the Titans are out of timeouts. 20-10, by the way. That was Bridgewater Emery Ethan over Viberg Hurley in that championship game where Jacobson put up all those records. Six touchdowns. That's a all-time, all-championship record.
Regular season and championship, in fact.
Wow. So Chase Hall pursuing that. What a first half he has had. Titans trying to strike back. They'll send Helen in motion. Campbell, swing out pass, has Lochte heading for the sidelines, and he'll be out of bounds. Or check that, he's inbounds, didn't make it out of bounds, but he got a first down at around the 12-yard line.
Nice job after the catch by Lapke as he knew where he had to go and was able to dive forward. Not quite the first and goal. They can get a first down without a touchdown, but first of all, no timeout. Secondly, 43 seconds. Third, 12 yards away from getting the score.
Campbell will roll out. He'll run. He's heading for the sidelines. He'll be tackled inbounds at the 6. Titans are going to have to hurry. 30 seconds and counting.
Might very well see a spike here.
We could. Let's see. Nope, they're not lining up for a spike. As Helen will check out of the game. Emery back in. They'll run a play. Campbell looking. Throws. Short. Incomplete. Intended for number 4. That is Emery. Evan Emery.
And a very nice play by Hewer defensively as he made sure, if nothing else, even if he caught the ball, he was going to stay out of the end zone with a defensive effort by Hewer. This first half just been one for the ages.
No kidding. What an explosive offensive effort by Potter County.
I'd like to know, I mean, they've had at least 3 touchdown passes on the first plays of drives today.
I think so. My goodness. I mean, just a quick strike offense for Potter County.
Against a very good Leola Frederick defense. These are not cheap efforts. They are taking on and beating a very good defensive team in the Titans.
10 seconds left. Campbell looking to throw. He's got a wide open field. He'll scramble. He'll get there. Touchdown, Titans.
Nobody close for Potter County. As he went back to throw, Campbell saw everybody covered, saw a wide open pass to the end zone, headed off to the left side. It's 38-22. Now he rolls to the left. Everybody giving chase. Colton Hall not quite able to get there. Chase Hall couldn't either. It's a touchdown, Leola Frederick, 38-22. And they'll try to make it a 38-24 game.
Spread everybody out. Put a man in motion. That's wiser. Campbell out of the shotgun. Throws quickly. Lochte has it. No good on the two-point conversion.
It was a short pass. Lochte had to go down for it, which broke his momentum a little bit, giving that man, Chase Hall, an opportunity to make the tackle, keep him out of the end zone for the two-point conversion. We have a 60-point first half here with 5 seconds left. 38-22 is the score. Potter County has the lead on Leola Frederick, but given this, they are not going down without a battle.
6 plays, 66 yards, and a 1:48 time of possession. Potter County has scored a touchdown on every 3.8 plays for average. That is unbelievable. I've been here at the Dome for 20 years in a row now, and Canastota put up some gaudy numbers in the nine-man ranks, but
right.
I think even they had to run about 4 or 5 plays to score to get their touchdowns. My goodness, what an offensive explosion. Well, this was a 12-7 regular season game.
Right. And I think a lot of people were expecting something that
in the 20. I was expecting a game, to be honest, in the 20s, maybe one team getting to 30, but boy, we've got 38-22 after 2 quarters of play. My goodness. King will line it up for the Titans. And he'll try the squib kick. Oh, bounces through the hands of one of the players, but Storer collects it. And the first half is done. Potter County, 38. Leola Frederick, 22. A lot of offense in this game.
And you can't really say it's all Potter County in the first quarter. It looked like it would be. But Leola Frederick is just refusing to go down here without going down swinging. They're within 16 points. We'll go down to Craig Maddock with an interview as we go to the halftime. Craig?
Coach, are you more shocked you only had 10 yards rushing or 350 yards passing in that first half?
I think it's a combination of both. I wanted to be able to do some runs and use some of the clock and so forth. But right now our passing has been working so well that we have to keep on doing what's working for us.
It seems the tide of this game has changed going from the run now to the pass, both teams.
It is. They've got, right now, we've got to figure out some things defensively to stop their offense. We knew that coming in that they had a good offense. I don't know if people expect that we had the potency that we do, but we've got to go out and be able to take charge in second half and kind of reestablish momentum on our side.
Thanks, Coach. Good luck.
Thank you.
There he goes, 38-22. Potter County with the lead over Leola Frederick. Halftime coming up here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Welcome back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, the Class 9A Championship football game here on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm Steve Toome along with Gary Ellenbolt and Craig Maddock. What an offensive explosion we had for the first half of this 9A championship game. Potter County with a 38-22 scoring edge, and records may fall by the bundle here today.
Well, we have one already in nine-man football with the 359 passing yards. Taking a look at the halftime statistics, of course, you see the score 38-22, 14 first downs for the Leola Frederick squad. They get 94 yards at the ground, 157 through the air, a lot of that coming late. 14:55, the time of possession. That is a very misleading statistic because Potter County has been that efficient, that good offensively. They've scored on one play several times in their drive. 359 yards through the air, 369 yards total, 10 yards on the ground, which really for a nine-man school is just about unheard of.
And coming into this game, Chase Hall on the season threw for 984 yards. He also ran for 762. But the passing game has just been there so far for Potter County, and they've had so many quick strike scoring drives. Yeah, it seems like their offense hasn't been on the field a whole lot.
Vern Smith's game plan is just working beautifully here. Wanted to open things up. Of course, you want to try to run the ball a little better than really they have. Leola Frederick had 94 rushing yards, which is certainly not a great statistic when you compare that they got 251 total yards, which is about 148 fewer. They're 118 fewer than Potter County came up with. But, you can't say it's been all battlers here today because Potter County has had a very good game, obviously, 38 points in the first half. But Leola Frederick has found the end zone and found some things that they can do offensively.
Chase Hall, 9 of 13 passing, 359 yards, 6 touchdowns. Unbelievable first half. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back with more. This is the Class 9A Championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Championship event is brought to you in part by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Farmers Union Insurance, by SDN Communications, and by the Independent Insurance Agents of South Dakota.
We're back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. Halftime of the Class 9A Championship football game. Potter County leads Leola Frederick 38-22. And what an exciting first half of football it is. Gary Ellenbolt joins yours truly, Steve Toome, Craig Maddock down roaming the sidelines today for this 9A Championship game. These two teams met in the fourth game of the regular season. It was a 12-7 game played at Potter County, but Boy, it didn't take Potter County long to eclipse that point total. They had jumped out to a 25-0 lead at one point in the second quarter.
And really sent the message early. And the very first play from scrimmage, Potter County had the ball. There you see the brain trust from both schools talking it over. There is the pass to Hewer. Beats the defender. Nobody was going to get him. They come up with the score. Very first play from scrimmage. And normally you'd say the route is on, but Leola Frederick still in this one as they had some good scoring in the second quarter. Now here is the play that leads to the recovery. There you see the recovery by Potter County. They score a couple of plays later and just trying very hard to let the air out. There you see a bit frustration on the part of Marty Morlock, Leola Frederick. There is the pass. Able to come up with the touchdown back of the end zone. That's the second score, and plenty more to come in the game, Steve.
Yeah, here's a throw by Chase Hall down the sidelines to Tanner Hewer. He has three touchdown catches and 170 yards receiving in the first half. Leola Frederick came back. That's Logan Weiser with the touchdown catch. He has 104 yards receiving on four catches in the first half for the Titans. Dane Campbell is 7 of 17 passing, 157 yards, two touchdowns. But Chase Hall, six touchdown passes, and that ranks him seventh all-time for any game ever. It's the most in a title game, and he is 41 yards shy of the all nine-man championship game record. Now, if you want to talk about all-time, Tate Bruckner from Menno had 512 yards passing in a regular season game, I believe it was, back in 2008. And we want to thank our good friend Dan Gensler for providing us the stats. SDSportsHistory.com, I believe, is the webpage. And he's been running up here passing us notes. So our thanks to Dan Gensler for that. Let's take a timeout. We'll come back with more. This is the 9A Championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. We are back at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, halftime of the Class 9A Championship football game. A lot of points scored so far. Potter County leading Leola Frederick 38-22. Six touchdown passes for Chase Hall in that first half on nine completions, 13 attempts overall. That's a pretty good passer rating.
And a couple of good games yet to come today. We've got the 9AA championship in a couple of hours here at the Dakota Dome as Arlington will take on Bridgewater Emory Ethan tonight. All the marbles in Class 11A. One team, a fixture at the Dome all these years, and another team who has never been here in championship contention. That 11A game, Madison and West Central. Tomorrow we get started at 10:30 Central Time, 9:30 Mountain. The 9B game with Avon against Hamlin. Only game featuring two unbeaten schools.
Yep, and those teams obviously not meeting in the regular season. Canton versus Parkston. That'll be the 11B championship game. Those two teams met in the regular season with Parkston getting the win. Canton, they've been the road warriors in the playoffs. Two wins on the road to get Canton to the Dakota Dome. And then we'll wrap up the Friday night games with an ESD showdown between Pier and Watertown, 7 Central, 6 Mountain Time. That'll be the start of the 11AA championship game on Friday night. And then on Saturday night, we'll have the seventh and final championship game, the new class, 11AAA. It's Lincoln versus Roosevelt. Lincoln unbeaten. It was a 7-point win for Lincoln versus Roosevelt during the regular season. We'll start that at 7 o'clock. Central, let's send it down to the field. And Craig Maddock.
Coach, you got to be happy you scored in your last three possessions in a wild first half.
Yeah, we that first quarter was kind of rough on us. We weathered that storm, and our kids really came back in that second quarter, and we found some things that worked. And you know, one thing we didn't account for in defensively is it appears that that ball carries a little bit better here than it does outside. And you know, our kids were there to make the plays, but that ball just carried over the top of them, and they were able to capitalize on that. And we talked a little, changing up some assignments on the defensive side, and hopefully we're have a little bit better half on this one here.
Coach, good luck in the second half.
All right, thank you.
All right, there we go. It's getting ready for the start of the second half. As Potter County leading Leola Frederick back to Steve and Gary in the booth.
Thank you, Craig. And you mentioned something, you know, and I never really thought about the ball carrying a little bit better inside the Dakota Dome here as the passes from Chase Hall have sailed over the hands and heads of the Leola Frederick defenders for several touchdowns in that first half.
And you really don't have a way to adjust for that because this is the first and only game that these teams will play indoors this year. It's just a matter that Potter County has handled it a little bit better than Leola Frederick has with all the long touchdowns that they've had. But you can kind of see Marty Morlock's point that, you know, you're not used to the indoor conditions. You've got the turf to factor in. You've got the roof. You've got the warmth. You have got, you know, just the fact that there's really no atmospheric condition that's going to change the flight of the ball at all.
No, and sometimes the background is a different when you're trying to field punts and kickoffs. It's more into play. But sometimes when you're looking for that pass, either as a receiver or a defender, and you're looking back up over your shoulder, sometimes you may lose it in the roof here at the Dakota Dome. Of course, they put on the new roof about 10 years or so ago here at the Dome, replacing the tarp with the solid metal roof here. And sometimes that throws things off a little bit. But for Potter County, boy, they've been firing on all cylinders in that first half with 369 yards of total offense, 251 yards of offense compared to Leola Frederick. Relatively penalty-free, not a whole lot of them in that first half, and plus about 5 minutes or so on time of possession for Leola Frederick here as the teams continue to go through their warm-ups, getting ready for the second half of football. Here at the Dakota Dome, of course, Bridgewater, Emory, Ethan, and Arlington will follow this game in the 9-AA contest.
It's going to be interesting to see what kind of adjustment Leola Frederick is going to be able to make in the second half, especially with the way the ball's carrying. Of course, they would need to stick a little bit tighter on the receivers, and that has been kind of a bugaboo for the Titans because Potter County has been able to beat the defensive backs deep today. But if you stay with them and compensate for the fact that conditions are as close as you're going to get to perfect in any situation, then they might have a shot to come back here or at least slow down the Battler offense.
Yeah, the Titan defense has shut down the running game. The problem is the passing game has just been, again, just perfect today practically for the Potter County Battlers. And they've been able to get some pressure on Chase Hall, but Hall has done a great job of throwing on the run. He necessarily has, quite often he's throwing off his back foot, but he's getting enough zip on the ball to get it to his receivers downfield, and they've gotten behind the defensive backs time and again.
And as good as Hewer has been, he's really shared the wealth among the receivers. Colton Hall's come up with a good couple of good catches. Roush had the touchdown earlier in the half at... They're just showing that they have a lot of weapons and a lot of great things they can do. There you see the Leola Frederick squad down 38-22, clustered around their head coach for the second half, Marty Morlock. The Gettysburg Battlers making the slow walk across the field, as you can see on the long shot there. Vern Smith and the Battlers with two quarters to go and 24 minutes of playing time before they can be declared for the first time in school history a football champion.
Yep, Gettysburg has been here seven times previously and walked away with the runner-up trophy every time. One more quick thing statistically, Tanner Hewer is 25 yards away from setting a 9A championship game record. He has 170 yards receiving, 195 is the record. And really for this first drive, important for Leola Frederick to get some points. And we're wondering about the all-time, yep, that's Nick Hofer. That's the all-time, all-classes nine-man championship game of record as far as yards receiving. Of course, 400 for passing for Corey Jacobson, 41 yards away, is Chase Hall.
And, you know, it's not that the Titans are out of this, but if they can score, and if they can get a two-point conversion, all of a sudden 38-30, what are you kidding? We got us a ball game.
Yeah, their defense will have to obviously play better in the second half. We'll see how the adjustments work out as both coaching staffs had time to go over their game plans. It will be Potter County kicking off. Chase Hall, the man of the hour, will do the honors, dropping back deep. Logan Weiser, and also Justin Helen. 12 minutes on the clock. Here we go. Second half of football on South Dakota Public Broadcasting, the 9A championship game. And they'll send it deep, Will Hall. Helen, that is on seven. Picks up a block. Tripped up at the 25. Again, the great special teams play by the Battlers.
It looks like he might have tripped up on his own man there, too, as Helland was coming toward the far sideline, moving right to left. There he goes past the 15. Now watch Jimmy King here in the area. Yep, he ran into King, and then down he went.
And I think grabbing the ankle there was number 40, Tim Hine, sophomore, special teams player. So Dane Campbell leads out the Titan offense. We'll have the double wing set. Handoff, Weiser, tripped up, tries the right side, lost a couple of yards.
And that has just been the MO of the Potter County defense. They've done a pretty nice job on trying to stop those sweep plays by Leola Frederick. That time the Titans lose two. They will go to second down and 12 from the 23.
Vern Smith, the head coach for the Battlers. Put a man in motion, handoff up the middle, hurdle, has a hole, gets across the 30 to the 31-yard line.
Really a nice play as they sent Weiser toward the left side in motion and then gave it to Hurdle, creating just enough confusion, just enough hesitation on the Battler defense in order to get yardage to the 31. So they get the original loss back and a few more. It'll be third down and four.
Again, the double wing set. Quarterback keeper Campbell going to try to muscle his way forward. A good surge by the line. This will be close. He may be just a few inches. Boy, this is going to depend on the spot.
And just a pushing exhibition that time. Leola Frederick pushing forward. Potter County pushing back. Michael Roush helping out with the stop. And Leola Frederick will get the first down.
They got just enough real estate to move the chains. A big first down there for the Titans as they'll switch out some personnel. As Dane Campbell, the senior quarterback, 47% completions on 55 of 118 coming into this game. 1,032 yards, 18 touchdowns, 5 picks. They'll spread things out, put Weiser in motion. Three-man rush. Campbell has time. Got a man. It's Helen across midfield. Down across the 40. First down, Titans.
Helen changing his momentum in midair to come up with the ball. He was leaping for it. And it just kind of was thrown behind him, twisted his body right there, able to come up, twist forward, keep his balance, and get nice yardage for the Titans to the Potter County 38, first and 10, Leola Frederick.
Titans on the march once again. Their offense was much better in the second quarter than in the first quarter. Campbell fires, got a man, Padal, he slips and falls, and he's automatically down right there. Short gain on the play, maybe 3 yards.
More or less a turf tackle that time on the part of Padal. He was able to come up with the catch. He was going to turn and go upfield, but lost his footing on the pro turf here at the Dakota Dome and went straight down. You can see there Campbell bobbled the snap for a second, but good presence of mind to haul it in, come up with the grab. It's second down and 7 for Leola Frederick.
Double wing set again. Weiser in motion, takes the handoff, cuts inside. He'll get maybe a couple of yards, maybe 3 on forward progress, down to the 28.
Started the work outside and then took a quick step inside and was able to pick up about 3 or 4 yards on the play, making the stop for Potter County. Trayson Brew, 6'3", 215-pound junior.
3 minutes into the third quarter. Titans on the first drive of the second half. They're down by 16. Double wing set as Weiser in motion. Campbell retreats, now throws. Got a man incomplete. Padal was open at the 10, and he lands hard. Gets up slowly. Let's hope he's okay.
Campbell with good presence of mind to get the football off at all because he had a couple of Potter County defenders right in his face. They just about got to him. Campbell might have had to hurry the throw a little bit. And incomplete pass with Padal, the intended receiver. It's now fourth down and about five to go for Leola Frederick.
And Padal has to come out of the game, the leading receiver here, on a fourth down play for the Titans. We'll spread things out. Campbell throws too high and incomplete, intended for Helland.
Sundberg almost with the interception there. Helland had one hand on the ball and knocked it away. Sundberg with the interception attempt. No such luck. And the news gets worse for Leola Frederick as they're called for holding.
And obviously that will be declined by Potter County, and they'll take over
holding
on downs.
On the blue will be declined. First down.
Well, what he said. First down and 10, Potter County. Leola Frederick with a great opportunity and moving the ball down the field, but just couldn't get it done in Potter County territory.
And so the Battlers offense onto the field here, led by Chase Hall, 6 touchdown passes. That is a championship record. And the Battlers in their road white come to the line of scrimmage. They'll stack it up in the I formation. Handoff. First carry of the game for number 22. Not much there for Potter County, as that's Tanner Storer, a freshman, into the game. And he gets maybe a yard.
He had to do an awful lot of work to get that yard because there were a bunch of Leola Frederick players up there in the backfield. Storer went right, went left, went right again, went left again. And barely picked up that yard. So it is second down, 9 to go. Battlers with the ball and the lead at 30-22.
Shotgun set now. Sundberg into the game. It's a quarterback keeper. Penalty flag down. And so is Hall after about a 2-yard gain.
And coming up with the stop for Leola Frederick, Nathan Sumption making the stop. Penalty flag is down, and that happened just after the play started.
And procedure the call against the Battlers.
I'm a little surprised they let the play run, because normally the clocks or the whistle is going to blow the play dead right away. And when the offense keeps going, that leads one to believe that maybe it's a penalty on the defensive unit. But not that time. It will be second down and 14.
Not enough men on the line of scrimmage. So second down.
Makes it second and 14. And now three wide receivers out to the right. Hall rolls out, throws under duress, got a man here again across midfield, first down.
And notice that Helland was right there staying in back of Hewer the whole time. Gave him the reception, but no more. And Helland put the licking on Hewer, but not before. The first down goes to Potter County, and the Battlers have the ball at the 49 of Leola Frederick.
Pretty spiral. Coverage was good, but Hewer was open again. I tell you what, Hall throws a pretty pass while he's on the run.
He does, and that is hard to do for anybody, let alone a high school young man in a championship game.
Here comes the pressure. The middle screen set up to Sundberg. He'll get to the 45, across the 40. Helland trying to rip him down, but Sundberg muscles ahead across the 35 to the 34. First down, Battlers. And even when they get to Hall, he wisely throws the screen pass.
Can't wait for you to see this replay. We'll have the opportunity, I think, to see Sundberg with his yardage after the catch of the collision. Just puts together a beautiful run afterward. And, they're starting the play right away, so we'll go to that instead.
Sundberg stays in as a game as the running back with Hall. Fakes the handoff. Hall wants to throw. Now he'll have to try to run, and he runs out of time, and he'll lose a couple of yards on the scramble.
Leola Frederick doing a much better job getting into the backfield as they have had the opportunity to really make Chase Hall's life kind of difficult here in the second half. Hall has had a lot of navy blue uniform players in his face as he's tried to get the offense going.
Second down and 12 coming up for the Battlers.
And Jimmy King, as you see, is heading off the sideline. Looks like he's favoring an ankle now, which for your kicker isn't good, either if it's the kicking foot or the plant foot.
Could be a leg cramp, too. We see that quite often here at the Dome. Second and 12. Colton Hall to back. Chase Hall throws on the run, and he's got a man. It's Huer again. Somehow he pulled it off the turf at the 15-yard line. First down, Potter County, and for Huer, that should give him the all-time receiving record.
Huer played that perfectly. You see Hall throwing over the middle, just about hit, and Huer with the diving catch kept it off the ground. Nice grab for Potter County. Huer and the Battlers to the 14-yard line of the Leola Frederick Titans.
And that should be a nine-man record there for Huer. Hopefully we'll get the official word in just a moment. As far as receiving yards goes. Misdirection running play, and this is Huer with it. He's to the five, and he'll be tripped up near the goal line. Not in, but a first down nonetheless coming for Potter County.
You wouldn't want that any closer or any prettier of an offensive play short of a touchdown. You see Chase Hall getting some instructions from head coach Vern Smith here. Huer took the handoff, and on the misdirection, nobody near him. He just about got into the end zone. First and goal at about the 1 foot line for Potter County.
The all-time championship record for yards receiving from Derek Oldert of Rapid City Stevens back in 94. He had 216 yards against Yankton in a Max Hawks last game as a coach for Yankton. And Potter County approaches the line of scrimmage. And it'll be Hall rolling out, throws quickly, and he's got another touchdown pass. This time, it is Michael Roush.
Michael Roush coming up with his second touchdown of the day. It is now 44-22. The Battlers have doubled the score. See the rollout right side. Hit as he throws. Hall to Roush. Hauls it in, no problem.
I think it might have been intended for the other receiver there, Dalton Storr, but Roush just stepped in front, stretched out his hands, and caught the touchdown pass.
Just found out Tanner Huer, number five for the Battlers. 214 yards receiving, breaking Nick Hofer of Canastota's record in 2012 of 195 yards. So another record falling on the part of Potter County.
We'll take a timeout, come back with more. This is the Class 9A Championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Welcome back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. Steve Toon, Gary Ellenbolt, Craig Maddock here. Mike Hendrickson will join us later on today. 9A championship game. Records falling by the wayside as Potter County has built a 45-22 lead over Leola Frederick.
And what I was trying to say, that Tanner Huer has had five catches, 214 yards, and the three touchdowns. The yardage does break Nick Hofer's record of 195 set, well, a year ago.
And he is 2 yards away from the all-time all-championship record of 216 yards by Derek Oldert of Rapid City Stevens back in 1994. That was a wild and crazy game against Yankton. I remember it well. Here's the kickoff from Chase Hall. It's going to bounce and hit towards the sidelines, but it's going to stay in bounds and picked up by Weiser. Busts through a couple of tackles, gets across the 30.
Weiser had to wait until he was going to confirm whether or not the ball was going out of bounds, and it looked like it would from the trajectory, and then it just kind of bounced straight into the air. Wisely picking it up, getting out to the 33-yard line, first and 10, Leola Frederick. A 23-point differential on the scoreboard as Potter County gets another touchdown from Roush.
And here comes Campbell, has time, throws over the middle. Padal with the catch, busts away from one tackle, gets across the 40. Nice gain on first down to the 41-yard line. Call gain of about 8.
Padal making the catch, and he does some very nice running after the catch. Still a little unusual to see number 55 come up with a reception like that. Picked up 8 on the play, and on the grab, it's second down and 2 now for the Titans.
Titans need the score on this drive. Weiser in motion. The handoff up the middle hurdle. He'll have the first down for Leola Frederick.
Just a simple play up the line. Go as far as you can, far as the blockers will take you. Just get short yardage to the first down. Mission accomplished for Leola Frederick as the Titans will park it at their 48-yard line.
Under 6 minutes to go, third quarter of play. Titans probably have to score on every possession from here on out. Handoff up the middle. Decent game for Karsten Hurdle.
You know, going back to that last drive from Potter County, that was basically the Hall and Hewer show. Look at Hewer, who had that deep catch, the diving catch to get them the first down, and then Hewer once again getting the handoff and getting down to the one-foot line. A play later, the Battlers able to score, and that was after the Titans turned it over on downs, where it was 38-22. They had a chance to come within 8 points and didn't get it done.
Hurdle checks out of the game, limps off to the sidelines. Pump fake, the throw to the swing out pass. Padal with the catch. Gets by a man down to the 32-yard line before Simon brings him down. First down, Titans.
And again, very nice yardage after the catch from number 55, Padal. There's the throw. Campbell setting up. Had time. Quick pass to the left. It's complete. Right in the breadbasket of Padal. Gets himself to the 35 and down to the 31-yard line. Simon, the nice tackle. First down, Titans.
Receivers all over the place. Four wideouts. The pass. Helen caught across the 25. He fumbles the ball. It's scooped up by the Battlers. And Colton Hall has it. It's a catch, a fumble, the second turnover of the game for the Titans.
And the ball lost as Helland was going down to the turf. He was not down yet. If a knee is down, then that stops the play. But Colton Hall right there, able to come up with the fumble. A nice recovery, just about broke one before the tackle was made. So Potter County takes the ball, put it up at their own 45-yard line.
Yep, there you see Helen. He lost it clearly. The knee not down yet. Colton Hall picks it up and gets a decent return before he's knocked out of bounds by one of the offensive players there. That was Nathan Sumption. Hall with the ball. He'll run it and get across midfield. Nice gain on first down for Potter County as their offense back on the field.
And Hall, the leading rusher for the Battlers this year, had a lot of opportunity, or really needed a lot of opportunity, to run in the game today. One thing that's really impressed me about the Battler defense is they always seem to go after the ball when they're making a tackle. They'll try to punch it out. They'll try to slap it out. Whatever they can do to separate the Titan carriers from the ball, they'll try to do. And a couple of times, it's worked very well for them.
Yep, Paul with three carries for 2 yards total now. He's been dropped for a couple of losses. I said here, the nice tight formation. They'll pitch it out to Storer. He turns the corner. Got inside the 45-yard line, down near the 42-yard line. That's Dalton Storer, the junior, who has played wide receiver and running back. It's enough for a first down for the Battlers.
And not a problem getting the yardage for the first down for Storer as he took the deep pitch. Rolled to the right side and was able to come up with some nice yards to the 41 as the Battlers trying to put Leola Frederick away, but a lot of time. But the Titans got to get a move on. It's 45-22.
Titan defense needs to make a stand. Misdirection play. Colton Hall slips containment. Penalty flag down. This one's going to come back. Big block downfield. Hall down near the 20-yard line, but the penalty flag near the line of scrimmage, and this one's going to come back.
That will be a block in the back call that is going to go against Potter County, so you'll negate the nice run from Colton Hall and bring it back 10 yards from the spot.
And the Titans will gladly take that penalty. We've got a Titan player down on the far side of the field being tended to by one of the trainers here. Cannot see which player it is. Waiting on the official word from the referee. Now the umpire will march it off.
Put the ball all the way back to the 49.
On White. 10-yard penalty, still first down.
Okay, I had thought the original preliminary call was block in the back. Holding is going to be the official and final word on it, and that is going to bring Potter County all the way back to its own 49-yard line, where they go to first down and an awful long way.
Herner, the
injury, timeout.
Yep, Herner, the injured player for the Titans, and he'll be helped off the field. Hopefully, the young man will be able to return to action here. Speaking of action, we'll have more next week. Volleyball, the championships at three different locations. You'll see everything online at sdpv.org. Then next Saturday, the 23rd, at 6 Central, 5 Mountain Time, we'll have all three third place and championship matches. As you see, the channels there, Class A on SDPB1, Class B on SDPB2, Class AA on SDPB3. Volleyball championships next week on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Plenty of football left here. And the I formation. Hall wants to throw under pressure. Floats it downfield. Got a man. That's Colton Hall. Cuts back to the middle. Pulled down at the 30-yard line as Chase Hall has to pick himself off the deck at the 40-yard line. He took a shot, but it's going to be a first down for Potter County.
And that really affected the flight of the ball, just the fact that he was hit as he threw. Here he comes, back to throw. There's the hit. The wobbly pass that Colton Hall has to come back for.
I'm out.
And now look at this incredible run that he has. Gets around Padal, can't get around Weiser, who makes the stop. It will be first down for Potter County, and the Titans call a timeout.
Yes, they do, with 3:42 left to go here in period number three. Potter County up by 23 points, and if they get a score here, they really put the Titans really behind the eight ball. Don't forget to join us on Sunday, the 17th. South Dakota Public Broadcasting will present the premiere of The Gettysburg Story. 150 years later, America's greatest battle is recounted for you as you've never seen it before. It's The Gettysburg Story, providing a unique bird's eye view of Gettysburg National Military Park. That's Sunday afternoon, 3 Central, 2 Mountain Time on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. And that is a fantastic program. Just want to correct the graphic there. It's 3 Central, 2 Mountain Time in the afternoon on Sunday, and a fantastic program.
Indeed, and of course, we've got a team here representing Gettysburg, South Dakota. Mm-hmm. Do you know who Gettysburg, South Dakota's sister city is?
I do not.
It's Gettysburg, Pennsylvania.
Well, that was seemed a little too obvious now.
Kind of why I asked you.
All righty, here's Chase Hall under center, pitches. Storer turns the corner, tripped up, pulled down near the 22-yard line.
Helen making the tackle for Leola Frederick, and if Storer is able to get the corner and get upfield a little bit faster, he probably shakes loose from Helen, but the play kind of slow to develop. You could see the lane developing along the far sideline, and Storer took the pitch, went forward, picked up 9 yards, but could have had more, had he gotten there just a little quicker.
Chase Hall, one of six players in nine-man history with 400 yards passing in a game in the regular season or playoffs. There's a handoff up the middle. Fullback dive gets it down inside the 20 near the 16-yard line.
Mitchell Hinkley with a pass reception for a touchdown. Runs at that time. Gives Potter County the first down. The Battlers going to the 16-yard line of Leola Frederick. Time a-wasting now for the Leola Frederick Titans. 2 minutes 45 in the third, down 23 points.
And we've just been updated here. Chase Hall only 9 yards away from Chase Marceau's record 454-yard passing effort last year against Washington. Chase Hall, well, pretty much only needs one more completion at the rate he's been throwing the ball downfield. Colton Hall, the deep back. Pitch. Oh, is he hitting the backfield?
That was Padal, who maybe took a little bit of an afternoon's worth of frustration out on Colton Hall, as Padal able to break past his offensive lineman, really virtually untouched, and got around the legs of Colton Hall, bringing him straight down. Padal with a nice stop.
And that's what the Titan defense needed on that first down play. It'll make it second down and long. There you look at Derek Padal. He is a senior. 6'2", 200 pounds. Sundberg now the running back with Chase Hall. He fumbles it. It bounces to Sundberg's hand as Weiser grabs the jersey and nearly ripped it. Loss on the play, but more importantly for Potter County, they're lucky to keep possession.
Nathan Sumption ever so close to coming up with the fumble recovery and giving Leola Frederick the football, but not able to haul it in. Bounced off the turf. Hall was able to come up with the scoop, but they lost some yards in the process. Infinitely better than losing the football. Look how close Sumption was on that play. That was Sundberg rather than Hall who came up with the grab. And then Weiser and some others get a hold of an awful lot of jersey number 23 and bring him down. It is third down and about 16 to go.
Chase Hall with Colton Hall standing next to him. Shotgun set. Throws on the run. Caught. And out of bounds near the 15-yard line.
Hinkley.
And that should be enough for a first down for Potter. Or check that. No, it won't be enough for a first down. Short gain on the play. They got back to almost the original line of scrimmage, so it'll be fourth down and 9 coming up. You see a little rollout here. Again, the pass just floated beyond the receivers and right into your living room as Hurdle makes the tackle.
Garrett Roush has come into the game now for Potter County. And they're going to try a field goal here. This will be a 30-yard attempt, certainly a makeable kick for Chase Hall.
From the right hash mark. It's down, the kick on the way, plenty of distance, good!
Chase Hall, 30-yard field goal and nothing to it.
That would have been good for about 45 or 50. That had plenty of distance on it.
You mean 45 or 50 miles?
Almost.
Wow.
Chase Hall with the field goal for the Battlers. They're now up 48-22 with just 42 seconds left here in this third period of play, and the Titans have had a couple of opportunities here, but they turn the ball over on downs on their first drive of this third quarter, and then not too long ago they had a fumble which was recovered by Potter County, and it results in a field goal.
So 48-22 is the score as Potter County is increasing its lead on Leola Frederick, 48-22. Scheduled for a 2:30 Central Time start for the next game. We should be pretty good with that as Arlington and Bridgewater Emory Ethan in 9AA.
Well, we still got another quarter here to go, and I'm thinking that's probably going to be closer to a 3 o'clock kickoff for that because some extra time will be added in the between the games.
Well, they have to have the championship trophies, et cetera, and the Joe Robbie Award and all of the things they do between games.
So we'll rough guess it here as that'll probably be a little bit closer to 3 o'clock when that 9AA championship game will be going. It all depends on how long the last quarter will take. We're at 42 seconds left in quarter number 3 as Hall kicks it off. Chase Hall gets it down to Helen at his own 5. Sees a wall of white jerseys, can't get past them at the 22-yard line. And again, Potter County on special teams has been very, very good.
And their kicker, Chase Hall, has given them enough hang time where they can go down and make some noise against the Leola Frederick squad. So the Titans take over on offense. Ball will be spotted at around the 23-yard line, first and 10. With 36 seconds left in the third quarter, it's 48-22, Potter County leading Leola Frederick.
Titans need some points and need them in a hurry. As Campbell drops back, throws under pressure, got a man. Oh, and that's incomplete. Helen separated from the ball by Chase Hall.
Helen had the ball in his hands, and as soon as the ball got there, Chase Hall comes up with just a monster hit. There's Campbell rolling around, finds Helen. Helen with the catch right there.
Hall was waiting for him, and he didn't try to go for the interception. He waited till the receiver made contact. He was practically standing there just waiting for him and went shoulder pad to separate the receiver from the football.
For the short run-up he had a lot of torque in that hit, too.
Yeah, well, it helps when the other guy's coming at you at a pretty good speed. Here's a halfback pass. They'll swing it out to Padal, and he's got some room. He'll get to the 30, and then Hall brings him down there near the 32-yard line.
Needs to get to the 33 for the first down. He's certainly going to be close. Very nice play. And now Padal, who has had a long game, down on the field for a second, and looks to be having an issue with an ankle.
Either that or maybe a little leg cramp there. And Padal, how many times have we seen him hit the deck, you know, lunging for passes that are just out, just beyond his fingertips? This little halfback pass, and there's the hit, and went down. Three battlers there. Third down and one coming up. The quarterback sneak, Campbell, and boy, this one could be close. He might not have made it on the quarterback sneak.
I'm not sure he did. It's going to be very close, probably close enough for a measurement, and the officials are saying, don't even worry about that. They're going to fourth down, I believe.
Fourth down will be the call.
Oh, they're going to go ahead and try the measurement. Looks like the official is going to bring the chains out. Okay.
Yep, chain gang coming out here with just 4 seconds left.
One official goes to a nearest 5-yard line just to kind of use that as a frame of reference, walks along the line, and then the rest of the chain gang will come out. And it is going to be astoundingly close. But he got it.
Got it by half the length of the football. First down, Titans. And the Titans convert when they need to there. They didn't need much. Didn't get a whole lot, but just enough for a first down for Leola Frederick. Not sure if the Titans will get off another play here. Just a few seconds left.
They may not bother. They might just take the final 4 seconds. And they've started the clock, and they will not get another playoff. Third quarter in the books.
You're watching the Class 9A Championship football game on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. Welcome back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, the Class 9A Championship football game. After three quarters, Potter County leads Leola Frederick 48-22. Titans with the football. Out of the shotgun. Campbell has time. Got a man, Helen. He'll be pulled down at the 40-yard line.
Nice bulldogging tackle that time by Sundberg, not giving up on the leg. Three quarters again gone. We are in the fourth quarter. Helen comes up with the 7-yard reception with the ball at the 41-yard line. So many records broken in this game. I feel like a radio station manager at the start of the rock and roll era.
The field goal that Chase Hall kicked sets a record. That is the longest field goal in 9A championship play, breaking Ray Tibbs of Stanley County's record he's held since 1986. He had a 23-yard field goal, that one by Hall listed at 30 yards. So he owns that record. He may own a bunch of them before the day is over. Put all in motion. Campbell throws downfield, incomplete. Weiser, the intended receiver.
And Helen in the area, too, kind of split the difference between the two. Weiser again intended, but short and off the mark. And it'll be third down and three to go as Leola Frederick try to get back into business. They have got a long way to go, down by 26 points, 48-22 the score, with 11:10 to go. Potter County the big lead.
We'll get you a stat update through three quarters here in a moment as Campbell drops back, throws, got a man. Helen slips a tackle, hit hard at the 46 and driven back.
Okay, we'll sort all that out. Take a look at some of the first half statistics. 19 carries, 44 yards for Potter County after three quarters. 448 yards in the air, 38 offensive plays, 492 yards, comparing to 58 for 342 for Leola Frederick. 19-18, the first down lead to Leola Frederick.
Potter County thought they had a fumble recovery there as Hewer came up with the ball, but the forward progress of the receiver had stopped as that pass goes incomplete to Evan Emery for the Titans. Remember, 454 is the all-time, all-class passing mark held by Chase Marceau last year against Washington.
It must be the name.
Chase, yeah.
Chase Hall, 6 yards away from tying that record. He's 15 of 19 for the game, 448 yards.
and 7 touchdowns
in 3 quarters.
8 is the all-time record. There's a fumble. Campbell has to pick it up, and he will just be stopped right there as Corey Jacobson did that for Viberg Hurley in 2010, and Matthew Raba from New Underwood back in 96 had 8 touchdown passes in I believe those were regular season games.
Fumble looked like one of those that happened when you're not anticipating the snap coming there, because Campbell didn't even get a chance to get his hands down and kind of bounced off his leg, but they recovered.
Weiser in motion. Campbell throws. Got a man out of the reach of Padal at the 8-yard line. Incomplete.
Some individual statistics after 3 quarters. Tanner Hewer, 5 catches, 214 yards. His longest, the 80-yard touchdown. Colton Hall with 2 catches. Chase Hall is 2 for 28 punting, a 14-yard average. As far as rushing, Hurdle leading the way for Leola Frederick at 42 yards. Dane Campbell, 12 of 25 passing for 215 yards. And the leading receiver, Padal, was 6 for 78. And the punt coming up now for Jimmy King of Leola Frederick.
Titans may go for a fake here. It's 4th and about 12. King will boot it away off the side of his foot, but it takes a pretty good bounce. And Hewer's just going to let it bounce inside the 20 and down around the 17-yard line.
Keep in mind, Jimmy King has left the field a couple of times with a sort of tender ankle. And that's very tough. Again, we mentioned is the kicker, whether it's the kicking foot or the plant foot, if you get an issue with that, you're not in for a lot of fun, because both feet equally important. And the leg cramp situation is certainly valid, too, in the warm conditions here and the relatively dry air.
Yep. People don't realize it's an awful dry in here, and it's a great place to play football, but you do have to prepare ahead of time. Drink lots of water before you come down to the dome if you're going to play football. Here's the pitch to Storer. Potter County keeping it on the ground. They'll get out near the 25-yard line.
Helen slowing Storer down just enough for Sumption to catch up and make the tackle, but a pretty nice gain for Storer as the Battlers will pick up 7 yards. It'll be 2nd down. Roughly 3 to go. We need to get to the 27 for another 1st down. Potter County just needed to hang on here as the Battlers leading the Titans 48-22 in quarter number 4 from the dome.
And the clock can't run fast enough for Potter County. They've been here before as Gettysburg. Haven't won a championship. They're very close to doing it right now. I formation for Potter County. It's going to be Colton Hall up the middle. He'll dart his way through traffic across the 30. First down, Battlers.
Just a tasty hole on the right side. All Colton Hall had to do was run through it. All the defenders split. Hall gets the first down and a little bit more as the ball is going to be placed at the 31-yard line of Potter County and the Battlers. 9 minutes and 2 seconds from the school's first ever state championship, at least in football.
And Chase Hall taking his time, looking at the official downfield. Will they want to milk as much time off that clock as they can? They'll stack it up in the eye. And Hall keeps it. Oh, it may have been a busted play, but Chase Hall is across midfield. He's across the 30, and he's brought down near the 24-yard line on a quarterback run by Chase Hall. I think he wanted to hand it off to somebody. Nobody was there, and he just took off and had a huge hole.
This is a young man with more than 700 yards on the ground during the 2013 season. He's able to slip away. All right, there's the handoff attempt. Not able to get it to Hewer, so he's just going to take off himself. Great protection of the football. There's Emery with a chance to get at him. Weiser comes in, does a great job cutting off the angle and making the tackle. And or Weiser, I should say. Excuse me.
And we've got a
timeout. Blue.
And Leola Frederick will take some time to talk things over here. 8 minutes and 33 seconds to go in the fourth quarter. 48-22 score. And
want to talk about no cover, no minimum coming your way on Saturday night after the 11 AAA championship game. Cheryl Crow, the featured artist. SDPB recorded her performance at this summer's Jazz Fest presented by the Sioux Falls Jazz and Blues Society. So staying with South Dakota Public Broadcasting, after the football on Saturday night, No Cover, No Minimum, featuring Cheryl Crow, a great performance.
And if you think a change will do you good, then you watch the 11 AAA championship game and then go right into No Cover, No Minimum with Cheryl Crow.
If it makes you happy.
You're good. I am rubbing off on you, am I not?
I don't know if that's a good thing or not, but I like Cheryl Crow's music, have for a long time, and it was a great performance at Jazz Fest this summer. You'll see it. Wow. The best of that performance.
And, of course, summer, always great weather for Jazz and Blues Fest because I want to walk in the sun, too.
Absolutely.
Your turn.
Well, let's get back to football, shall we? First down, Potter County. I formation, and they'll hand off to the fullback up the middle. That's Mitchell Hinckley, and he'll crash his way down near the 15-yard line.
Basically, Potter County is doing what Potter County wants to do right now as far as chewing up time. They don't need to have the big pass plays anymore. They've got the 26-point lead. They just need to get as much time off the clock as possible. They get into the end zone, get a little more insurance, then you know they will certainly take that. But they don't have to be fancy here the rest of the way.
Hall again taking his time. He'll have Hewer at a wing back, Hinckley at fullback, and that'll be Sundberg at tailback. And he'll get the handoff, and he's swallowed up right away by Weiser and the rest of the defense for the Titans. Matt Weiser on the tackle. He wasn't alone. And the loss on the play of a couple of yards.
Weiser and Lapke, great accountants and good tacklers that time too, as they just wrapped up the ball carrier Sundberg and brought him down. It is a third down 7 situation now for Potter County.
Again, Hall will take his time coming to the line. Has Colton Hall at tailback, Hinckley at fullback, Hewer the wing back, play action, throws, on the run, got a man, touchdown, Burglars! That's Michael Roush, 8 touchdown passes. It's an all-time tying record. Chase Hall has tied the all-time record, 8 touchdown passes in the history of nine-man football.
And Roush with his third touchdown, they do the play action, faked it into the line. Roush all by his lonesome thanks to the fake, thanks to the pass. Not an issue for Roush to get into the end zone. And here's Chase Hall to try to make it a 55-22 game.
And if I remember correctly, as the point after kick is no good, it is missed by Hall. But that should give him enough yards to break Chase Marceau's record for all classes of high school football. That young man has thrown for more yardage than anybody ever in a championship game. And I tell you what, after I witnessed that game last year, as you see the scoring drive, Chase Marshall's record, I thought that was going to stand for a while. We are waiting for the official word, but it appears to have fallen here today. 6 plays, 83 yards, 2:58 time of possession. Remember, this was a 12-7 final score in the regular season in favor of Leola Frederick, 54-22.
Remember, it was 38-22 at halftime. The Battlers are known up in Potter County in the Gettysburg and now, I guess, Hoban area as the Mighty, Mighty Battlers. Mm-hmm. And they have been exactly as advertised this afternoon here at the Dakota Dome and really sent the message and set the tempo of the game from the very first play.
Yep, the first play, a long touchdown pass of 65 yards, and then they got that fumble recovery early on. Scored again. And I tell you what, the Titans have just been trying to play catch-up all day, and they've gotten within a couple of scores. But then Potter County, they've extended that lead. 32-point edge here with 7 minutes 1 second left to go in this contest. High end over end kick. Helen looking for a reverse maybe. Well, he'll keep it, and he'll be drugged down at the 27-yard line.
Penalty flag is down. More than likely on a return, a block in the back going against Leola Frederick. We'll wait for the official word. Scott Glow with the tackle for the Battlers, who are 6:54 away from the title with a 32-point lead.
Block in the back against Leola Frederick, so that'll back up the Titans as they'll start this drive with 6:54 left. And the ball will
block in the back. 10-yard penalty. First down.
And just like a holding call, that is something that is measured from the spot of the foul. So you're going to put the ball back to the 17-yard line, and Leola Frederick will get it going.
Titans down by a bunch and under 7 minutes to go. They'll send trips receivers out to the left. Campbell looks to throw. Dodges a tackler, throws high, incomplete at the 30-yard line.
And he was one step away from going down on a Scott Bloke sack, but Campbell was able to work around that, fire the pass. It's still incomplete, but it's second and 10 instead of second at about 14 or 15, as it would have been with the sack.
That was Nathan Sumption, the intended receiver. Four wideouts, two either side. Left-handed quarterback Campbell out of the shotgun. Pump fake, throws. Intercepted by Simon. He gets down to the 5-yard line as he jumped the route.
Marty Morlock's got to be thinking, what next? 6 minutes, 42 seconds to go. Here is Campbell looking for the open receiver. Found one, but the guy was wearing the white jersey. And there is the run back to about the 5-yard line. And a timeout called. We'll take a timeout and come back as Potter County gets the ball. You are watching the Class A State Championship on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Welcome back to the Dakota Dome, SDSportsHistory.com. Dan Gensler's been running notes up to us here all game long. Crazy eight. Eight touchdown passes for number eight. And, well, we've got to mention SD Sports History, brought to you by Mariah Press. And crazy eight. Eight touchdown passes for number eight. That ties an all-time nine-man record. And if Potter County wins it, it'll break a... or their losing streak as far as championship games when they were here as Gettysburg. Let's get back to action here. As Hinckley goes in motion. Here's the pitch to Simon. He gets to the end zone. Touchdown, Potter County.
Nothing to it for Simon as he leaps over Lucas Callis and as a defensive end spot. Flies about 2 yards into the air to get the score, but he did it. It is now a 60-22 lead for Potter County. There's the pitch. There's Simon, gets past a couple of guys. Callis there going for the legs, and Simon wouldn't let it happen. It is 60-22.
I believe that's the first rushing touchdown today for Potter County.
It would be, yes. Eight touchdowns through the air, and now this one, and they go for two.
And 464 yards passing for Chase Hall as they'll try to go for the two-point conversion. Hall throws off his back foot, incomplete. 464 is an all-time, all-class record for championship play, breaking Chase Marceau's record from last year. One play, 5 yards, 2 seconds, time of possession.
And the intended receiver on the two-point conversion attempt was Chris Zuber into the game, number 17. Zuber is a 6'1", 146-pound senior. Potter County has just had an impressive, impressive show of football here today.
We have Chase Hall down for 16 of 20 passing, 466 yards, 8 touchdowns. That ties an all-time 9-man record. And he also has some rushing yards to go in there as well, as you see a recap of the drive there. So what a performance today by Chase Hall. And credit his offensive line, too, for giving him some time to throw. His receivers have been running great routes and sometimes having to come back for the ball. But, Potter County just, firing on all cylinders.
I don't know if this is a statistic or a record that's kept, but I just wonder if anyone has had a championship game with an 80% completion rate.
for this many passes, with a certain number of pass attempts.
You know, you're like 3 out of 5 or something like that. That's not as impressive as going 16 of 20.
Yeah, I mean, it's just been a great effort today by Chase Hall and the entire Potter County team. They're up with 6:40 left to go in this game, 60 to 22. 580 yards offense on the day for the Battlers. 353 for the Titans. It's not like the Titans have played a bad game offensively. Yeah. They got 22 points on the board, but just Potter County has just been near perfect today.
Here's Colton Hall with the kick.
Weiser mishandles at the 5. He'll have to scoop it up, looking for some blockers. Shifts through a couple of guys. Gets to the outside. And he'll get near the 40-yard line before he steps out of bounds.
Jordan Schmidt helping out in the stop. Schmidt is a junior, 6'1", 175-pounder, able to push Weiser out of bounds, but a great return considering he dropped the kickoff.
And we'll have some reserve players coming in for Potter County on defense. We'll try to pick them up as quickly as we can. That is Troy Albler on the defensive line, number 90. He is into the game. Well, again, we'll try to catch up some of these reserve players. The starters look like they're coming out for Leola Frederick. Tanner Storer, a freshman out there as a defensive back. Caleb Minky out there, a junior. He's at a defensive back. Out of the shotgun, Campbell, pump fakes. Got time, being chased, there's the pressure. It throws Assumption, and there's a penalty flag down. Assumption knees down at the 45-yard line.
Flag is going to be down right at about the 35 in the area of a hold, more than likely.
Now, Assumption a legal receiver or not? He is a guard. And, yep, threw it to an illegal receiver.
All right.
And out comes the second unit offense now for Leola Frederick with 5:30 and counting here in the final period of play.
Kyle Kinzer will come in. He's the quarterback, 6'1", 190-pound junior. Also in, Jacob Hamm, 5'11 lineman, a junior. All right, and Frederick Lapke is into the contest. We are running on a continuous clock now, Steve.
Yep.
Illegal touching. On blue, that penalty requires a loss of down, second down.
Yep. Continuous clock now because the lead is more than 35 points. So the clock will keep going, even on out of bounds and penalty plays. There's a handoff up the middle, no gain whatsoever there for the running back for the Titans.
That was Frederick Lapke who came up with the handoff and just got nowhere. It was a beautiful play defensively by Potter County, and some of the reserves are tasting some action here in the final 4:35. Again, running clock the rest of the way.
Man in motion, he'll get the handoff, slip through one tackle, fights his way to the middle of the field. Big hit, gain of a couple yards on the play for number 34. That's Jordan Haas. He is a freshman.
Getting up off the pile, Chris Zuber for Potter County. A fourth down, 12 to go. They need to get to their own 48 for the first down. And now the first string offense is coming out, or at least most of it. Jimmy King is coming in.
He'll do the punting duties.
Okay, at fourth down.
Caleb Minky, I thought he was going to drop back for the moment, but Potter County is going to stick close to the line, look for a fake. Here comes the rush, and it's a good punt from King. Nobody back at all for Potter County, so the ball just roll. And it'll be down around the 13-yard line.
Accidentally kicked by one of the Titans at about the 14. Kicked it to the 11, but the official right there, the umpire, moving it forward to its rightful spot. First down and 10, and Potter County will have it at their 14, leading big 60-22.
And the reserves coming out here for Potter County. That means Chase Hall's day is done. He won't break Tate Bruckner's 512 yards passing record from 2008. That's an all-time nine-man record for passing yardage in a game, but he's got 466, and that is an all-time all-class championship record.
Some more of the players coming in for Potter County.
And I think we're going to have a timeout call by Leola Frederick. They're going to make sure everybody is out there that needs to be out there, make sure everybody is aligned, even if they're in your reserve unit. And that is the final timeout call by Leola Frederick. Well, coming up after this contest, we'll have the 9AA Championship Arlington against Bridgewater Emory Ethan. Both teams have tasted success at the Dakota Dome in the past, but for Arlington, they have back-to-back championships in 04 and 05. Haven't been here since, and of course, Bridgewater Emory Ethan, they won back-to-back championships 2 and 3 years ago.
And Arlington, with a really nice run in the middle of the last decade, as they had won 32 straight games, including those two state championship contests.
And I believe they also won a state B basketball championship in that run. They had some really, really great athletes. Yes. And, of course, Bridgewater Emory Ethan, a traditional powerhouse behind their great head coach, Jeff Van Loor. That'll be our second game of the day here at the Dakota Dome. And the reserves out there, Minky at quarterback, and he'll pitch. And that's Storer with the ball, and he'll get near out of bounds. Tanner Storer, the freshman, so you're getting a look at the future here for the Titans and the Battlers, respectively, in the final 3 minutes of this contest.
One of a couple of Storers on the team, the other being Dalton Storer, who has one touchdown to the Battlers' credit. Now coming into the game is Carl Cronin. Cronin, 11 in the program, but switched jerseys to 81. He is a 5'3", 110-pound freshman, and he's lined up left side.
Handoff up the middle, fullback dive, and a little bit of yardage gain there.
Caleb Menke is the quarterback. Also, Jordan Schmidt is into the game.
I think that was Garrett Roush, I believe, who got the last carry.
Chris Duttenhofer is into the contest, 5'10 sophomore. And substitutions akimbo for Potter County as David Long is in. And also Tim Hyen is coming in.
So a chance for a lot of people to play. I think Oriel McGromer into the game. Number 39, he's a foreign exchange student from Spain. Handoff up the middle, that is Hine with the ball. And he'll get a couple of yards, clock continues to run.
Stephen Haas is in for Leola Frederick, he's number 41. Ethan Erickson, 6'1", 180-pound junior. Also, Jacob Enge is a defensive back, 5'9", senior.
Third down play coming up here for the Battlers. And it's a quarterback keeper.
Flag is down, though, Steve.
Yep, Jacob Roush just kept it that time. And the clock will keep running and false start the call on Potter County.
Just about everything went right this entire game for Potter County today, Steve. They had put on just a masterful performance.
On the white, still third down.
And for two teams that battled 12-7 during the regular season, never would have thought we'd see 82 combined points. But it has been Potter County's day. They're just moments away from claiming the championship. Handoff up the middle, and they'll bounce it to the outside. Running back for Potter County, turns the corner, gets the first down. That's Lucas Smith. That's the coach's son, who gets a carry in a championship game. Vern Smith and the Potter County Battlers are your 9A champions.
What an effort by the Battlers, setting the tempo of the game from the very first play on a long touchdown pass. On a record-setting day for Potter County, the Battlers, their quarterback, just about everybody connected with Battler football, having a stellar outing today, Steve.
Yep, everything just worked perfectly for Potter County. I don't think they had a turnover in the game. Chase Hall lights them up for 466 yards, 8 touchdown passes, tying an all-time nine-man record, tying Corey Jacobson and Matthew Raba, who have also thrown eight touchdown passes of the game. And if that 466 yardage mark is correct, that is an all-time, all-class championship record. Simply put, Chase Hall today put on one of the finest performances in the history of high school football in South Dakota.
He just had a day that he will remember for, well, a lifetime, as will the rest of these Potter County Battlers as they come up with the 60-22 win, defeating Leola Frederick. Leola Frederick, previously unbeaten, a team that had beaten Potter County, but a little bit of revenge in the state championship game for the Battlers.
And in a moment, we will have the presentation of the awards as Potter County is going to do the jumping jacks there, their traditional post-game ritual. There you see the coaches going through the handshake line. There's the Battlers working out after the game. A lot easier to do those jumping jacks after you claim a victory, especially a state championship, the first ever for the Battlers of Potter County. Gettysburg was here seven times. Seven times they walked away with the runner-up trophy. Not today. Let's send it over to Greg Merrigan. He is our public address announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I direct your attention to the center of the playing field to present the awards to the 2013 runner-up and championship teams for Class 9A football are Darren Paulson and Dan Whalen from the Board of Directors of the South Dakota High School Activities Association. Assisting with the team awards presentation are representatives from the Activity Association's corporate partners, Trig Odney from Sanford Health, Brian Hansen from Farmers Union Insurance, and Sergeant First Class Daryl Bird from the South Dakota National Guard. And first we will present the runner-up trophy in this 9A championship game. They finished the year with an outstanding record of 11-1. Head coach Marty Morlock and the Leola Frederick Titans. Trophy, head coach Vern Smith, the Potter County Battlers. Now we have a number of individual awards to present. Each year, the members of the media covering the state championship games select the Joe Robbie MVP, the outstanding performer in the championship game. Presenting the award will be Ann Breitag, representing the Vermilion Chamber of Commerce. Our Joe Robbie MVP had quite a day. He threw 20 times, completing 16. For 466 yards, eight touchdowns, he had eight tackles and one pass breakup. Our Joe Robbie MVP from Potter County, Chase Hall. The South Dakota High School Coaches Association selects an outstanding lineman, and an outstanding back in each of the championship games. The coaches have selected Carson Kirby of Potter County as the outstanding lineman. And the Coaches Association has selected Chase Hall of Potter County as the outstanding back in this championship game. Fans, we had a number of records in this 9A championship game. Potter County sets records for most first downs by passing with 15, net yards passing by a team with 466. And as an individual, Chase Hall sets a championship game record, net yards passing with 466. And Tanner Hauer sets a championship game record with 214 yards pass receiving. And Chase Hall sets a championship game record for longest field goal with 30.
Here with head coach Vern Smith, Potter County. Eighth is the charm, isn't it? Gettysburg has never won a state title. You've been a part of a number of them. You get one today.
I tell you what, this is awesome. This is one that these kids told me, believe it or not, the seniors told me back in sixth grade computer class, we're going to do this. And they've been with it all the way through. And there's a lot of guys sitting up in the stands that believed all those times we came down here that we could do this. And it was one of those that there's a lot of people that this is for up there in the crowd and on the field. That's just one of those that's amazing.
You've done it on the ground all year long. What happened today? 466 yards passing.
You go with what works. I knew we wanted to come out passing the ball because we thought when we played them the first time, we thought we were able to complete some passes against them, and we just missed by inches. Today, we didn't miss by inches. We were able to hit those passes, and when that first play came into play, I knew that we had to keep on going with it. We're able to run the ball a lot of times, but they're very physical up front with putting a lot of people in the box, and we had to press the ball, and we knew that we were able to catch the ball and pitch the ball around, and so we had to keep going with what it was.
First play of the game, how often did you practice that this week?
This week once. We've run it several times. We brought it out for the first time against Howard, doing a little bit. And basically it puts people in tough position as far as defensively, and we look for mismatches. Tanner Hewer had an awesome game for us catching the ball back there. Obviously Chase Hall had a great game passing. And if they're able to do that, that means everybody else did their job as far as blocking up front. And that to give him the time to do that. It's one of those, once we started passing the ball and we were having the success and the focus, we had to keep on doing it. And obviously it worked for us today.
Congratulations.
Thank you. It's one of those, I'll give Leola Frederick tons of credit. They were able to pass the ball on us as well and got us back on our heels on that first half. And our kids stepped it up and played a great second half as far as defensively stopping them.
It's a great game, Coach. Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you. I hope everybody had fun with it. I had fun.
Thanks, Coach.
Thanks.
9A Gettysburg, your champions. More from the Dome when we come back on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Free statewide broadcast of this South Dakota High School Sports Championship is underwritten by the thousands of members of the Friends of South Dakota Public Broadcasting, by Mid-Continent Communications, and by Dakota Bank.
Welcome back to the Dakota Dome in Vermilion. There you see the Potter County Battlers celebrating their first championship, a convincing 60-22 win over Leola Frederick, and what a day for the Joe Robbie winner, Chase Hall.
Chase Hall, all he did was come up with 16 of 20 passing, 80% completion rate, 466 yards, 8 touchdown passes, his longest an 80-yard pass for a touchdown in the game. As far as rushing, the leading rusher for the Battlers, 4 attempts, 51 yards, and came up with a 49-yard run. Just about busted for a score. His average 12.8 yards per game. Tanner Heuer, the receiving leader, five catches. A lot of those for scores, three of them, in fact. Grand total of 214 yards. He had an 80-yard touchdown play in the game. Michael Roush with three catches, 34 yards, and three scores. Colton Hall, two for 60. Mitchell Hinckley, two for 53 yards and a touchdown. And kick returns, Dalston Storer, two for 40. Carson Kirby, one for seven. And the leading tackler, Ryan Sundberg, with 11 total tackles, one and a half for a loss.
611 total yards of offense. That's shy of the mark of 705 set by Kimball in 2001. 466 through the air. That is an all-time record for nine-man football. Actually, that is an all-time all-class record. 145 on the ground for Potter County. Leola Frederick. Dane Campbell was 14 of 32 passing, 228 yards, one interception, two touchdowns. 24 first downs for Potter County, 20 for Leola Frederick. Time of possession, about plus 4 minutes for Leola Frederick, but three turnovers really hurt the Titans, and they just couldn't get it really going in the second half. They had some drive stall, and Potter County turned it into points. Let's send it down to the field, and Craig Maddock.
Chase Hall. Chase, what a day you had. Did you have something special for breakfast today? 16 of 20, 466. Nobody has thrown that many yards in any South Dakota high school championship game.
I don't know what was going on. Maybe I was sleeping still. I don't know. All I had this morning for breakfast was a waffle and a Snickers. So, I mean, if that works, use it.
This season, you got a lot of work done on the ground. How come it got so interesting tonight where you were able to do it in the air?
All year we've been run dominant. A lot of my run yards came off of pass plays just because they were so open that we were able to pick up lead blocks out in the open field and pick up yards. So, I mean, to come in here and throw this, it's amazing.
Your coach said that you guys since sixth grade have been talking about doing this.
Yeah, well, of course, I didn't live here in third grade or sixth grade, but all the other kids did. And I mean, I've been wanting the same thing wherever I was at. I always wanted to get to the dome, and it's amazing to get it.
Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
Chase Hall, the Joe Robbie winner here in the 9A championship. The Battlers win it. More from the dome coming up on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
Potter County celebrating the 9A championship here at the Dakota Dome in Vermilion, the first of seven games over the 3 days in the books. 60-22 the final score, Battlers over the Titans.
And I think we may have a new training regimen across the state of South Dakota.
And Snickers.
If Chase Hall can do what he did today with a waffle and Snickers for breakfast, I mean, you just clean the entire community of Vermilion out of waffles and Snickers. All the stores are open right now. Go get it done. Let's just, we'll try some research here.
There's some second half highlights, and this game was very much in question at halftime as Potter County had a lead, but there you see the touchdown pass to Roush. Two receivers in the area. Roush comes up with it, and then a pass over the middle. Fumbled by Helen, picked up by Colton Hall, who got a nice return for the Battlers, and that really stymied the Titans' effort in the second half. And here's another pass downfield.
Roush again.
That is his third touchdown catch of the game.
And Matthew Roush with a great effort, just some good efforts all the way around. Here is the interception and a very nice run. Just about to the 5-yard line, first and goal. And then scoring a play later was the guy who came up with the interception. And there it is. Watch this dive right there.
Yep, that was Simon with the carry for the Battlers as they cruise to a 60-22 advantage. And Vern Smith finally gets to hold a state championship trophy. Again, Gettysburg here seven times. They came away runner-up for the eighth time. Number eight through eight touchdown passes. Potter County with the win over Leola Frederick. Again, 60-22. We're going to step away from the Dakota Dome for a few minutes, bring you Dakota Life. We'll be back roughly a half an hour with the 9AA championship game, Arlington and Bridgewater Emory Ethan. For Craig Maddock and Gary Ellenbolt, this is Steve Toome temporarily signing off from the Dakota Dome, the state high school football championships on South Dakota Public Broadcasting.